Hello, everyone, and we're back. And you're gonna welcome back Hassan. How was your vacation, my friend?
It was good. It was good. I'm back, refreshed, ready to go.
Yeah,
for the next few streams.
Nice and rested. I hope everyone was too. We took a break for a week, but now we're back, and we're gonna have so much content for you. Just completely jam packed. I hope you got yesterday's stream with Crying Suns. It was really amazing. Great developers from France that gave us a little bit of a peek into how to create 3D sprites. Using 2D only, it was really cool. So you definitely should go check it out. It's down there in the VODs. Go take a look. But today we have a really, really special stream. For if you didn't see already, we're going to be featuring Thomas Sala from The Falconeer. But before we head to that, Hassan, why don't you tell us what we shouldn't be missing for this week?
Yeah. So we're in the final week of the Smash Hit Summer Sale. We'll just jump to my screen and I'll show you that. It's called The Last Chance, so it's 50% off all the best sellers on the sale so far. There we go. Yeah, so we've got 50% off some amazing assets. Honestly, I looked through this and I think it's just one of the best like sales we've done so far. Like things that you definitely use in your project. A great like nature pack, asset pack for any kind of fantasy game or any kind of like just nature game you're making. A great top-down engine to help you build your game. Gaia Pro, you know, if you go to terrain editor, terrain tool, with great support. And then you have shapes by Freya, incredible like 2D vector tool. One asset that I really want to highlight is actually an asset that's being used in the game we're going to see today. So I'm just going to pull that up. So we have a Tail Animator by Impossible Creations. I'm going to play the trailer for this. So this asset was really crucial to making the Falconeer, and Thomas is going to talk about that, so I'd love to just highlight them right now. Let's play their trailer. So yeah, it's an extensive feature set. There's like so much for packed into this like one asset for just like $11.50 right now, half off. So definitely check that out. And Thomas is going to go, I think, into more detail about how this was like crucial to his project.
Yeah, and I think that Impossible Creation does a lot of stuff. So
yes, exactly. So many other kinds of like assets similar to this for different use cases. Check out their page. But besides the asset store, I just want to thank everybody who's been like watching the previous streams that we've now been uploading to YouTube. Mm-hmm. So any of the creator spotlights that you might have missed are now on YouTube, edited down to focus on just the good content. Like there's all the timestamps there, so go check those out. We've created a playlist on YouTube. There's some incredible content out there.
Yeah,
so I'll give it over to Carol now to introduce our guest and play the trailer for their game.
Yeah, thanks for all the comments, guys. You guys have been leaving really great feedback on the videos too. It really helps us hype it up. Tell us what you like from the streams so that we can continue making more content, and definitely suggest devs that you would like to see too. So for those who don't know, Creator Spotlight is a summer long series that we're doing. Every week we have 3 to 4 devs that we invite, all of them coming out with great games, all made with Unity games, of course, but are centered around different themes so that we can teach you guys how to become better game developers. So I'm super excited to feature the next dev. You guys have seen him here before. He was one of the first ever creators we featured for Creator Spotlight last year. So let's take a look at the trailer for The Falconeer.
Quiet. We are bound by water. It defines our existence. From the walls we erect to keep it at bay, to the ships we build to traverse it, we are its children. We take to the skies to be free, if only for a fleeting moment, until we inevitably return to the water, when our splinters sink beneath the waves as glimmering reminders of our fleeting escape.
This is it. A final strike. One for the history books. Good luck out there.
Such power we hold. Blacken the skies with our ships, our birds, our beastly selves. Yet we are powerless, repeating the same ancient play. The ocean, our stage, its waves set in motion generations ago, forever our home, our prison.
And welcome back, Thomas. So nice to see you here. Please say hi, introduce yourself, and tell us a little bit about The Falconeer.
Hi, I'm glad to be here. Thanks for the invitation. I'm Thomas Sala. I'm the creator of The Falconeer, which is, how to describe it? An air combat game on top of giant birds set in a sort of a fantasy open world. And it's coming out on Switch tomorrow and PlayStation 4 or 5.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Really excited about this game. We're going to talk a lot about the Switch release and how to deliver a multi-platform. But I just wanted to kind of mention, first of all, for those who don't know, this was developed by one person and you're looking at him right now. Do you want to talk a little bit about how it was like to develop as a solo indie developer?
Yeah, for sure. I think where to start? I'm an artist by trade, 3D artist that always been fiddling and creating. I've been in the game industry for since 2001. It's 20 years, I guess.
Oh my gosh. When you said that.
Yeah, I'm pretty old. and this game, I am a highly chaotic person that is not great in studio environments. I figured it out around the 18-year mark. I had always been, making stuff by myself. And at some point that became, for me, the best way forward, I felt. And The Falconeer is actually a game a little bit about that, about liberating yourself. It's, flying off into the sunset on top of a giant bird is a... It's very symbolic. I set off to make the game, and that took, I guess, when this starts, it's a 4 or 5 year range somewhere. It's all a blur because I'd started another project before that and never finished that. And
Such is the way. Of the indie
As is the way. As is the way. Oh, I have a better idea. But actually, that project was called Oberon Squartz, and it was something I was working on during a burnout. So at some point, I had a really massive burnout and working on that game. And once I went through that game felt a little bit dirty. How do you call it?
Tainted
by that. Yeah, it was a very dark and bleak game. And Falconeer is pretty bleak at times, but there's you know, this sense of wanting to escape the darkness.
Yeah.
That's, you know, present throughout the Falconeer, which is a little bit more aspirational, a little bit more positive. Those that have played the game on Xbox or PC realize how relative a point of that is. And I do the art. That is, I create the environments, the animations, the technical shading, the effects, the characters, the character animations, the coding for that, all the AI, all the gameplay, all the menus, all the stuff. Yeah, Unity Dev does. I don't make any music or sound because I suck at that. It's important to mention. I say it's a lot like a solo album by your favorite, you know, in a band.
Uh-huh.
It's a solo album, but definitely there's a support structure. I've got a publisher, they've got a QA department, there's someone, you know, running after me if I don't deliver on time. You know, there's people to assess me that's super experienced in porting to all these platforms. There's lots of support network around. That's worth mentioning.
Totally. Yeah. Shout out to Wired, who's in chat. Hey, thanks for helping out, Thomas, making this game happen. So for those who don't know, this game was actually a launch day game. So it was like, you know, you had all these consoles coming out. It was featured extensively across like PS and Xbox. So how does that feel for you? I think we should talk about that because, you know, you're releasing on Switch tomorrow.
It was scary. It felt scary. I think that was a little bit unreal because, you know, you have those moments in your life where you, looking in hindsight, was I really there? Because I was just running around like on autopilot.
Right.
Ever since I got the word, it's going to be a launch title for the Series X, Series S. That put on a pressure to deliver at a specific time because, you know, even though we you know, weren't aware of the specific launch time until fairly short. So there's a pressure to deliver. There's a pressure to make best use of the hardware because that's what a launch title is about.
Mm-hmm.
To, you know, so that was a fairly hectic time to get everything done in time. And support all the next gen stuff. So it does 120 FPS at 1800p, I think. It does 4K. Mm-hmm. It does all the HDR tricks. It literally throws everything Unity can do in post-processing at the game. And there's special content that only is, you know, for the Series X and S, you know, details in the world that are turned off and stuff. A crazy time all around, really. And then and then with COVID, it was a bit weird because, you know, there's all these giant shows and then you're not in Vegas, but, you know, you're just streaming it.
Yeah.
All in all, it's been a really weird blur.
So do you feel like that prepared you for this release this time around? Do you feel the same level of stress or you're better right now? You're a pro?
Well, actually, I got COVID about 3 weeks before launch and a week after the press version's gone out. And I'd screwed something up in the AI that made them super lethal. And I was just in my bed sweating. And that got fixed in the first patch when I got better. So that entire period is... that'll be a, how do you call it? Something to talk about for many, many Christmases.
Yeah.
This time around, much better prepared.
Nice.
Healthy. Had done it before. We had everything in order. And I think it's a calmer launch for me. So,
nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was so funny. So I think... when we first met and we're talking, we both referenced the same tweet. Shout out to Stephen Hovelbrink,
Death Trash.
Death Trash, early release. Guys, go check it out. He's a great Unity developer as well. Congrats. But he asked the question, any advice for anyone who's their first release? And everyone gave a lot of really great advice, like, you know, prepare and make sure that you have your social media, marketing, else. But you tweeted something and it got a lot of attention. You gave some really good advice, so maybe you can tell our chat what you said.
I basically tweeted, it's a sledgehammer and it's going to hit you emotionally, mentally, and be prepared. It's not launch day, it's not launch week, it's like a launch quarter. You know, you're going to be out of it for months and you have to sit down with your family and your support structure and make that very clear, because even though I've been in the industry for a long, this was the first game I launched that had, you know, attention. I've done a lot of work for hire, like everybody, you know, you hustle to get around. So this was, I think really the first time something personally I'd done by myself got this much attention and had a proper launch. And I had no idea. So it's like, it's an intense period that can really pull the carpet and out underneath of you.
Yeah. I think Hassan was asking too, it's like, you mentioned it was a sledgehammer, but what exactly, yeah. Which part of it?
Well, COVID didn't help, but I think for me was it I got a lot of anxiety. Well, initially before, because there's this tension builder, so there's a date coming up. That's the launch date. But then most people know that there's a review date from which, you know, the point where, from which professional reviewers are going to release their articles. I think that combined, and that those are a couple of weeks apart, or depending on, you know, if you're confident in the game, it's ahead of the game. This, if you're not confident, all these marketing things. But this was, I think, a week ahead of it. And even though there'd been previews and there'd been, you know, people saying lovely things, but it just frightened me. And I think for that week, while I was recuperating, I was also just a little bit hiding under a blanket where anxiety hits you, and then, you know, your entire body starts to, yeah, for me, it's lots of sleeping and stuff like that. So that's a proper, just a fear that someone might not like it. You put your entire heart and soul into something. The Falconeer, it's a homage to, you know, Crimson Skies and, you know, early this century and late 90s action air combat games. But it's also a game about, you know, something that's deeply personal to me. You know, about escaping and wanting to be free and all that, you know. So it's something that was wrought through personal work. And then for someone to have an opinion on it, in hindsight, I think I blocked that, and I sort of assumed there would be no opinions on it. It would just sell and that'd be it. You know, I had no preparation on how that felt, and the good and the bad, because someone said it's, you know, it's majestic, the Falconeer's great, it's a fantastic launch title, and then someone else might not like it because that's, you know, the way the cookie crumbles. Yeah. And it's an idiosynchronous, you know, one-man creation. So it's going to be upsetting to some people because it, you know, doesn't adhere to many conventions. And I think it's about as uncompromising a vision as you can get. Then someone having an opinion on that is just, I don't know. And especially if it's a negative opinion, it just... I've said before, it's like a positive review or someone that said, like, that just goes in and out. It's like, whoosh.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And but someone that says something spiteful, and people can be really harsh. Everybody knows that. It just sticks with you for days and days. And I found that incredibly hard just to put that aside, that, you know, any positive, it didn't work for a bit, you know, where I would just look at it. Yeah. Oh, maybe they're right. Oh, yeah. That's definitely wrong. And, it's great in a way because I got to, you know, you go into a mode where you, for me, it's a survival mode. It's, okay, you know, there's comments, there's critique, there's things that could be better. People want more diversity, whatever. And I just started working. So I have been working nonstop since November till, you know, about 1 or 2 months ago when most, just from that energy, you need to do better. You need to do better. And I think that's the dangerous bit where you can really overstretch yourself and get stuck in this, you know, you put something out in the world. So you're someone who wants to please, you know, you want people to like what you make. That is a base design. Otherwise you wouldn't be making it. You know, there's easier ways to make a living. So it's you want people to like, love, whatever, engage with what you make, because that's the other fear of nobody's going to play it. You know, that's you make something and it remains unseen, so nobody's seen your art. That is, you know, the tragedy of many artists, is that, you know, nobody ever engages with your work. Those are all very, you know, they aren't existential, you know, as in I need to eat. But some of that, you know, you run out of money, the game needs to sell for you to feed your family. That's fairly existential. And then there's all these layers that come on top that you always read from the, you know, actors and directors. I never read the reviews. You see them say that. I think you can't help yourself the first time because you just can't. You're not prepared. You're just going to read everything. I read everything. Every Reddit, every tweet, every troll, everything. I read everything.
Thomas, no.
Yeah, that is. I said, don't read any reviews. Don't just, not the good, not the bad, because it will only, you know, you will fixate on it. But you can't, so you're gonna. So prepare, and that's, you know, that's gonna take a little while for you to get over that and become a normal human being again.
Do you think if this were to happen again, like you were, hopefully it does, if you release another game, you would go through the same thing? Like if you were to read negative comments, or do you feel like you're better prepared to
I don't think,
them?
No, even now I'm better. It doesn't hit me, you know, doesn't, I don't get a full blown anxiety attack this time, right? But I can, you know, I woke up at 5 this morning because launch day is tomorrow. So 5 in the morning, I'm up and about nervously. So yeah, there's part of you that just, you know, wants people to love what you make. And that part of you always going to get hurt a little bit. And that's, you know, just the reality of life. You just have to grow into that. I think that there's, I don't know. I am a very stubborn person. There's a part of me saying, well, we're just not going to do this next time. I'm just going to release it, have zero fanfare, and see if I can engage with my community. And you see some developers do that. They just work within their own community. And I understand that, you know, that is...
they don't want to deal with everything else.
No, and when you're a solo developer, you become the brand of your own game. And that, because there's nobody else to talk to. Well, especially in this case, Benedict Nichols, who made the fantastic soundtrack. But beyond that, you know, to talk creatively about the work, that it's always going to be me. So you become a person in the public sphere. So that's on top of that. That's a choice. I don't know if that's always a positive. I think it's something to be mindful about.
Right. I think that's really interesting because I think that was the first thing we talked about was, I was like, you're actually quite a big figure in the game dev community, you know? You're a game dev of the game devs. Like, we all talk to you. I see, you know, tweeting a lot. And I think that's actually really important. You mentioned that. And it's like a choice, but I think it's almost necessary, especially this last year during COVID. I've mentioned this before, but it was really hard for people like me and Hassan to go find game devs and great games. Because usually there's a GDC for us to show up to.
Yeah.
There's an E3. People are preparing like all year long for that. And I meet those people there and they come to us and talk to us, but they didn't have any of that. So you had to be your own marketing person online.
There's part of that. I think without COVID, I wouldn't have tweeted that extensively. Because it's also, you know, it sounds really selfish because there's this, you know, artistic craving for validation of what you're doing. And if you start your own business, your own studio, it's the same. When you have no feedback, as well, so you have no one to reflect upon on what you're doing. Am I doing it right? You know, I have no idea. So you find a lot of indie developers, very experienced to very green, needing that reflection from other people who've you know, achieved that point where you can live off the games you make, because that's what people want. So yeah, I'm as needy as the next dev in, you know, wanting to show my screenshot Saturday and but wanting to talk about people, you know, how do you do this, you know? And you're right, I was at the last PAX East before the lockdowns hit. So I'm fortunate in a sense, because that was, you know, a great introduction for many people to the Falconeer. But after that, I've never seen anybody play my game. So I have not seen anybody physically play my game.
That's interesting.
That is such a handicap. But it's also, you know, so it's a bit part handicap. You know, I had a discussion with a journalist about the reticule for targeting being slow, and it was, you know, he was, and there's, everybody has muscle memory. So I can't look at what he's doing. And he goes, ah, you're playing it like that. Interesting. I have to read. And he goes, yeah, it just feels slow. And I go, it doesn't feel slow to me, but, you know, I made it. And so killing your darlings and getting honest feedback whilst looking at someone doing it is something that's just wrong, or it's gone. And so I watch a lot of streams, but it's not the same. You can't ask someone, oh, how does this feel and this setting or whatever. So having COVID makes you need to be more outgoing on social media. And it also toughens you up, because you lose, that's like I said, COVID is, this is, everybody has this problem, but you lose the camaraderie, but you also lose when you are the affirmations you get from being successful. So when it released, you can read a review, but there's no person saying, oh, I loved it.
Yeah.
You know, that's, there's no, you know, and that you search for it on Twitter. So I think that's why lots of people in the game dev or any artist have been on Twitter or so, whatever social media of choice, just to get that, that's called an affirmation from someone else, from, hey, I really enjoyed playing your game. Because people can type it, but, you know, you're missing the actual person.
Yeah, it's so funny. We had Oscar Salberg, the creator of Townscaper, on here, one of our first ever streams for Creator Spotlight. And he mentioned the same thing as you. He was like, you know, I used to work in AAA and it was like, it has its own limitations. Now I have so much I can actually share from beginning to end. Everyone knows about my project. He's like, but it was really nice to just turn around and see someone in the, you know, seat next to you and be like, did you like this? Does this make sense? Like,
that's the one thing. Yeah, it's, I think within our local communities and the indie dev scene, of order, you know, with play sessions and people organizing local meetups, mm-hmm. it's all been gone.
Yeah.
Decimated as it were. And that's, I think that's affecting people. And it made launching a game, I think for people that come after me, launching a game during, and probably going to be the same problem this winter. So if you're launching this year, or, you know, we're all become, it's likely there'll be a Epsilon variant. It is an additional mental strain, and it's going to make life really difficult for, you know, many releases. It is more difficult during COVID, mm-hmm. And it's harsher that way.
I wonder if that amplified the sledgehammer feeling of, like, when you get a negative comment, because, you know, you didn't get those human interactions beforehand to get, like, some positive and some negative in person, and all of a sudden you're getting all of the sentiment at the end.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's we had a beta test, but those are, you know, remote as well. That's always just stressful in itself.
Yeah.
You're out of your you can, if you see a lot of people, if you go to PAX, people come to your booth, so of course it's skewed, but they'll play your game and people will wander in and play your game, and you can get a sense of your, if your game is doing well, or, you know, if it's difficult, or if it's appealing to people, or if they walk away. And that is super important, and it also helps you feel good about your game if someone, you know, gets really enthusiastic, you know, okay, so there's an audience for what I'm making. And that's what the word affirmation is. It's just a human trait to want it, and we're all needy animals, especially me. But I'm looking forward, even though we've made great strides with streams and to meeting people face to face and seeing them play the game.
Yeah.
Even though that for the Falconeer is probably not going to happen, because it's already out.
Yeah.
We have a great question from chat, from Tilmit Derbril. He says, hey, Thomas and everyone else, how did you organize the whole project? Did you know from the beginning how to set deadlines for yourself properly and how much time you need for the different stuff you had to do for the game?
I've gone on record of not liking, I've worked in Scrum Agile setup. So yeah, but I was the worst at Scrum and setting deadlines. Put me in a team, I'll be the guy, hey, look, I came up with this crazy idea last night, let's do it. And then a project manager will go, no, get this guy out of here. You know, here's your Scrum list, go do that, update your Jira. I am terrible with that. And part of, you know, wanting to be free artistically was important for me, just to be able to go where I wanted to go. And that meant that's probably why the deadline for being a launch title was extra upsetting. But we did that when the majority of the game was done. Yeah, most of the last years were for me, I'm sitting at home, I'm trying to get my stuff done. You'll get blocked, you know, because some stuff is just not fun and you'll want to pound your face into your desk. I've let myself take the distractions of the thing that are fun. And I've allowed it myself because, you know, I had the support of Microsoft and I could feed my family up to a limit, but I had, you know, a fairly spacious time. So I had 2 years. So I literally took every day. And when I got stuck, especially for someone like me who's chaotic by nature, I think, how do I, what's my organizational principle is that I chose a game genre that allowed me, that played to my strength. So I love making landscapes and towns and places. That is my number one joy, and creating an emotional mood and setting for something. Whenever I got stuck on coding or making a hardcore system, I would allow myself to unwind and create a bit of the world, or create a new enemy, or do the stuff I love, instead of, you know, banging myself off the head or feeling bad about myself for not being having enough discipline. And then that devolved into a rhythm where I was just creating the world was my, how do you call it? My drug, my, how do you call it? My mental crutch to keep going. Mm-hmm. And that's why there's so much of the world in the game. It's all just me needing to be creative while doing the hard stuff. And the smart thing was to make a game that it makes use of that. So it's a flying around open world game at its core. And it's very nice to fly around, all relax and discover all these places. Yep. So every time I made something new, I could actually say to myself, it's okay, you're adding to the game instead of procrastinating or, you know, doing something else. I had a few things. I didn't play any new games. So the last new game I played before that was Breath of the Wild.
Wow.
I did allow myself some Company of Heroes or just some simple, you know, mental escape to relax, but no big games in that.
Is there any reason for that?
That's my trick, you know, is to find a system before and find a genre that allows you to do the things you enjoy, and that pick a mechanic that you will always find enjoyable. So one of the things I learned from the game I never finished was a real-time strategy game, is that's super hard to make fun, you know? You need story, you need great level designs, you need great AI, you need diversity for, you know, an RTS to become fun, you need great pathfinding. So it takes years before you can feel if the game is fun. And if you're by yourself, that is not doable. You know, that is not sustainable. Whereas with, you know, a flying game that's based on some simple action principle, I always enjoy that. I never not enjoy picking up the controller and having a fly around. And furthermore, that's always been enjoyable, especially if you have a new bit of the world. Oh, let's look at my new world, fly around it. So I have the same joy as the player. That is important.
That keeps you motivated.
Yeah, it keeps you motivated. And it also keeps you sharp because you have a mechanic that you can feel. So you always know when you're going wrong, you know, when you add a mechanic or you add a physics variable or something and suddenly doesn't feel right. It's a fairly simple genre, you know, flying around. So it's for me that helped. Pick something that is, that you can latch onto for a long time. You know, and that might be the games you play yourself, whatever, but if you pick up more than you can chew, it becomes too much for your mind to actually organize. Where if it's a simple thing that grows bit by bit, step by step, but it remains at heart that simple thing, you can keep going for a very long time.
So you were talking about it could take like a year and a half to find the fun in RTS. How long for you from when you started to when you had that fun flying like bird?
Weeks.
That you could just weeks.
With the first demo I made. Well, the first demo, I lifted on some assets and the textureless art style. I blogged about that and become semi-popular back in the 2014, I think, about not using textures and low poly 3D and all that. So I lifted some, and after I came out of my burnout, I had a period where I didn't want to do anything. And then at some point, I was re-energized, starting a family. There was lots of positive. So I had three kids during the development of this. I didn't have them, but my partner, she had them. But our family, we gained three children, all during development and release of Falconeer. So there was lots of... So I wanted to... I had some art and I had a dragon. So I'll make... And I was working on this day-night cycle, which we'll show later. Some day-night cycle code I'd started in a racing game I did the technical art for a little second game company by then. And I was, I'd made a nice little landscape because that's what I do. I have a dragon. Let's see if I can attach a third-person camera and fly around. That is relatively easy to code. There's probably assets on the asset store just for prototyping, which you can use. So I coded that, flew around, thought, I forgot how enjoyable flying around your own environments is. And then I had a look and thought, well, but dragons are, I just watched this at somewhere season 3 of Game of Thrones. So at some point I got dragons, not more dragons. So I like modeling stuff, so I'll make a bird. So it took me about 4 days to make a rudimentary bird in some Twitter somewhere. And then a couple of days to do the animation, because that's pretty difficult for a bird. And I stuck that in, and I was working on the day-night cycle. And the first time we played it, this big orange, golden hour, the sun was coming up in my very simplistic world. There's videos on my YouTube channel of this. I'm flying around. I go, oh, this is good.
Yeah.
There's something here, both storytelling-wise and, a bird flying. This is good. And then that just brought me...
Yeah, I remember that actually a couple years before I worked at Unity anyways, like some footage of that, the bird went viral on Reddit. It was like all everyone could talk about, because it's like, how do you make this bird? Why does it look so great?
Yeah. And it's but it did that for me as well. So that's, I think in total, that was a couple of weeks. And then that you have your big initial creative, adrenaline rush. Oh, I'm onto something. Mm-hmm. And you start building and adding stuff. So that you get immense amounts of work done for your vertical slice in the first 2-3 months after that. And that's when you, and once you have done that, that's when you need to say, okay, let's have some perspective here and shop it around, see if there's interest for this. And then I paused it a little bit, which I've done a bunch of times where I've just walked away from it, not feeling positive about it, just leave it for a little bit and come back. Oh, it's not bad actually. And do some biz dev or marketing. And usually when I tweet a lot, it's when I'm stuck. Let's do an emotional tweet about indie life.
Okay. Now I understand. when I see you on Twitter a lot, I'll keep an eye.
Pick up on that now.
You mentioned adding bits and pieces to the game. Like you said, you focused on the basic mechanics. That's really what you wanted to build around, and then you started adding content. Somebody, the Hunter 5173, asked a great question. Hey Thomas, when did free updates such as Batis, the Pirate update, adding the paid content like the Mongrous Hunter class, and now Edge of the World come to be? And how did you go about executing them?
Well, originally I'd said after the launch, after the launch title got done, I had assumed I needed to take a couple of months off to just recuperate. And we all know, so the game did really well on Xbox. It got all the support from Microsoft, and that made the launch at the same time on Steam snowed under a little bit. So it underperformed on Steam, and that gave me massive anxieties. And then, the only way to fix that and to get that going, one of the things, as a developer, you can't do much because it's an algorithmic store. There's not much, there's nobody you can call. Oh, please help me. I need to do better. And there was some issues with the mouse keyboard. And, the thing you have to sit... is you just sit and do it, you fix it. So the first weeks were just spent fixing these issues, that gone by, weren't shown. There's always something that goes wrong. And then, the best path forward is to update the game. This is my livelihood. I had a chat with my partner. Well, okay, I can walk away for it, or, I can fix what's wrong for PC players, improve it, and I'll do that because, I can't do that nonstop. I'll need to add content to, satisfy my creative nature. There was lots also that I couldn't do in the release. So content I had in my mind that filled out the world that was, you know, nagging me, it needs to be in there. And that just, you know, there that you, if you're in a game for 4 or 5 years, there's you, what you do at the end is you start scrapping stuff that's not realistic to be there on time. You say, okay, I can't do this, I don't know how to do this, this is a lot of work. So you start cherry picking the most important things and you focus on that. But I think most people recognize there'll be all these lost systems and stuff you've prepared that isn't, you know, fully used in the game because there was no use, or you saw no narrative purpose for it, or didn't have priority. So I combined those things, and I just there were things I wanted to do, so like the wreck diving and stuff like that. That all came together where I said, okay, I'll look at what I've got, and it came to be fairly rapidly. So I combined listening. So I sort of made a schedule for myself. Well, I'll spend a period listening to players, what they like, what they dislike, what their feedback is, because it is a niche game, and I wanted to, you know, widen the appeal. Because air combat is, you know, it's a genre that's been gone for quite a long time, except, yeah, you know, heavy militarized F-16s flying around shooting rockets, either on the highly sim or the more arcade. But, you know, this sort of World War One slow dogfighting had been gone. Mm-hmm. So I said, I'll just make periods where I'll listen to, you know, do my obsessive going on Reddit, reading everything, engaging with people, asking, why do you feel, or why do you not enjoy this part, or what would happen to the, and I just distilled things to do. So part of that was that. And because that is emotionally draining, or at least I felt both the engaging and both acting upon it, because you have to do stuff that sometimes doesn't agree with your inner self, where you go, well, okay, lots of people are selling it, but I don't believe it, because we're stubborn people. Otherwise, again, there's easier ways to make a living. Yep. So there's this kill your darlings thing, which is really hard. You said, I like the way it is. I like the way it is. But people are saying to me, okay, but they would like it to be different. You got to just shut up and say, well, okay, this is the part I can agree with. And then kill the bits which aren't good. So, and that led to fantastic stuff. And I would take a break from that by just adding new content, which was, you know, energizing me.
Yeah.
And doing the, you know, the storytelling I wanted to do, doing some experimentation. And that was actually a nice beat. So I'd add rockets. So initially it was just fixed fire guns to the game for the action parts, and then I added guided missiles, and that opened up a lot of interesting opportunities. So I had some time to actually make content that uses this, and some bosses that are interesting for that, and so I went through all the updates up until then, you know, there's in the, so the Edge of the World DLC, the Warrior Edition, that's what this one. That's really cheesy.
Physical game, so rare.
Oh, I've got all of them. I've got all of them.
Oh, nice. Oh, wow. They all have different,
everything is physical.
I love that.
Yeah, it's super. That's amazing.
I like how they're all within arm's reach.
I've stacks of them here because they just sent them to me. They don't all get physically sent out, but I get a bunch. Yeah, so the content would, you know, evolve, and even this last update contains a free update that adds lots of new stuff. So I would sit on Discord and someone said, if this is like a World War One, World War Two sort of, you know, feel, where are the floodlights? I go, floodlights. Oh damn, floodlights. I think I had it within 3 hours. I had every turret in the game had the big ass floodlight.
I love that.
It's incredible.
Smashing. So that's the bits where, you know, so there's the bits where you have to fix things where you don't agree. And sometimes users will come up with stuff that's just, oh yeah, why didn't I do that? Or why didn't I see that? You know, where they literally open your eyes to mistakes you made, or, you know, you, everybody has their own bias, and you have this tunnel vision. I think that's the word, you know, where it's, at the end you can only see forward and you can't. I think that's, it takes a while to do. So I think the good stuff for that started to happen only 2-3 months after release. So the first 2-3 months were just doing updates, improving the game, fixing issues, You know, there's like 14 hours of storyline missions, and people were breaking them. And you know, if you let a couple of thousand, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousand people play your storyline, they'll find ways to break it. You know, oh, I flew backwards on that mission and now everybody's dead. Oh, so there's lots of that as well.
So I guess that's why it's good to share early, right? Like, for examples like the floodlights and share early and often.
There is a branch I use. Steam is really good for testing out with people because it's so easy to update. So there's a special branch I can invite people from the Discord to use just for testing out new features and new content. And that's without those Discord users, a lot of the stuff wouldn't have been possible, because those are people are literally awake. I'll go at 11 at night. Hey, I made this thing. You want to check it out? And people go, yeah, I want to check it out. And they'll have really insightful feedback. And I think that's one of the coolest bits of, you know, getting this sense of community where it becomes a little bigger than just yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. We have a ton of questions, but before we get to that, we should just jump into, let's talking about this game, this art style. I think it's a very unique thing. I think all the reviews, if anyone has seen, played the game, seen even a trailer, you're like, wow, this is really unique. It's breathtaking. It's really beautiful. And you had a very interesting approach for it. And it's all feeding into optimization and how you decided to build it on different platforms and stuff. I think a lot of people appreciate that it's on 120 FPS on the Xbox, but it's actually, I think you told me that you built it with 60 FPS in mind because you wanted it to be on Switch.
I don't believe in 30 FPS because it's like, I don't know.
Get out of here with your 30 FPS. Sorry.
Get out of here. I've never liked 30. I remember back in 2001, we make web games. Oh, can I make it 40 FPS, please? Can I make it 40? That's at least better than 30. So I've always been on that fence. So 60. And so there's, I am a really bad developer. Sloppy. I'm really sloppy, not super advanced. So for me to keep a track of things, I need to use the simplest forms of tools. For instance, tail animator, I only use 10% of that. The 10% I could understand and memorize how to use it. And I look at this little trailer, go, I could have done all of that. But it would have required a lots more learning than I was capable of, other than, you know, focusing on my own game. So I always want to find simple solutions. That's part of, I lost my own train of thought. This happens. Going back to the art style, I like things to be simple so I can be fast and efficient and don't have to worry about things. So 60 FPS is oh yeah, that's why I went up with, so 60 FPS. So if you make a game, there is articles about time independent. So you run at 60 FPS, but you want the game to feel the same at 30 FPS, possibly at 20 FPS. It also needs to feel the same at 120, 240, or whatever extreme FPS people had. That means the math you do inside your game needs to be, you know, accounting for the delta time, or everybody in unit in time, delta time. And that is a highly fluctuating number. So, and it's not accurate per frame because it's actually the time from the previous frame. So once depending on that, and you use the default time independent stuff, you know, for instance, like the physics runs on its own timing. There is blog upon blog upon blog, which are fantastic, that go in depth about, you know, time, you know, just delta time, physical time, all the different time steps you have in Unity or any 3D engine. And I'm not smart enough to understand any of that. I know it will consume me and I won't have the mental capacity to deal with that in every code I write. So for me, it's easy to say, I'm going to make a game and it's always going to run 60 FPS. I have some, you know, I have some time delta times calculation. Not going to worry too much about it because it's always going to run on 60 FPS. That is, anybody at a AAA studio said, that is the dumbest thing to do as a game dev. But if you're by yourself, it is a shortcut you can take, you know. Yeah, as long as you're prepared to make sure you always hit that 60 FPS for the vast majority of users, you can say, well, I'll use it. It's a time-dependent game. So I use the on-update loop or one-on-update that does a lot of other on-update loops rather than the fixed-time loop to do all the core mechanics. And that makes it really tight. If it runs at 60 with the VSync, there is no micro stutters. There can be in certain hardware arrangements when you know Steam does its big screen stuff and stuff. But on the whole, technically, it's running at 60 FPS and it's updating the mechanics at 60 FPS, and that's solid. So that's where I started off. I've had to make some adjustments on Switch to make it run. But it's a thing I do where I go, okay, I can take the high road, the proper road to do it. Or I can take the low road and just accept I'll have to cut stuff, or it'll cause me difficulties in the end, like on Switch, and just do it that way. So that's a mentality I have. So that's part of it. That's the 60 FPS part. So that's the other part is the art style. Back in, I'd say 2005, 2006, in the 3D scene, there was this, I think it's still popular sometimes, this Radiosity and ambient shadows and stuff came out for your 3D packages for 3ds Studio Max and Maya, and we suddenly had these soft shadows and little dark ambient occlusion like effects in your renderings. So everybody who was a 3D artist was suddenly posting their 3D models on all the art sites. You know, look at my portfolio, gray models with just, you know, the ambient occlusion, radiosity, high quality lighting, just to show off their modeling skills. And I was one of those, and it looked glorious. And at the moment I saw it, I loved it. It was so simple, just gray 3D models. And it looked so physical. They had no material expression, no gloss, but they had the perfect shadows. You could, like clay, you could pick it up. I had been going out to the studio I worked up until a few years ago. So I want to make a game that doesn't use any textures, just has that feeling, you know, where you just have the geometry, let it be, and you do everything just with the light and shadow to make it tactile. And I started doing that in 2013-ish. And first I did it very primitively with, because, you know, I think there was a game that came out where the character was nearly black and lots of silhouetting. So used black characters, but a really colorful environment that didn't use textures. And I started to use Strumpy, I guess. That's a shader editor for Unity back in the day. And afterwards Shaderforge by Freya to make like shaders that had gradients based off their UV coordinates. That's where it started. And then realized I could move those, add sine waves to that, and then make that world position. So I'll make, if you look at the clip that's playing now, you see there's all these volumetric layers of fog in the, so that tower that comes up, it's slightly lighter blue at the bottom than it is at the top. Those aren't, you know, the Unity, how do you call it, atmospheric scattering or some of the fancy stuff. That's actually just math gradients based off the height, the angle of the camera, on everything you do. So that is, and the simplest that is just height fog. So if you make a fog on your 3D game and you give every shader you use, say, well, at height zero, it's going to be white, and at height one, that white is going to fade out into the real colors. It will look at as if it's coming out from a white soup. You know, it's that bottom fog effect. Basically, that idea is at the core for nearly everything I do with shaders, where I'll say, well, if something, not just from the camera and the angle of the sky, but for instance, every material will have the ability to have snow, and it just appears if it's higher in the sky. You know, if something's closer to the water, it'll become darker, you know? So I've got these lists of gradients, and internal gradients in every shader that says, well, yeah, wherever you put it, it takes on a certain environment color. And I started doing that in 2013 just because I said to myself, I'm not going to use textures for this game. So I'm not going to refer to normal maps, diffuse maps. So this was before a PBR or any of this stuff. I'm just going to use the math to do all these tricks. And I found I really enjoyed it, and it looked different. So I love... But it's just a kick. It looks it looked different from even the low poly stuff, because they were doing faceting and, you know, using baking lights and stuff. I've not baked a light in, you know, 5 years. It's really satisfying, and it's a false requirement. So there's nobody saying you shouldn't use any textures, but I've internalized it as part of my art, I guess. So that I get upset that the font and the text in the game still uses a font map, which is technically a texture. And I store, you know, I use texture technology and shaders, store stuff in textures, and, you know, I render Perlin noise and that store this thing. But, you know, the idea that something pre-made came from Photoshop or, you know, and is in the game. If you take these weird requirements, it can be really inspirational, because it forces you to make solutions completely different than you're used to using. Right. And that leads you to new interesting avenues that led me to the water in the game, and that led me to create canyons in the water. And go, what the fuck's this looks nice, let's put that in the story. Just from it being an interesting avenue from the not having things at your fingertips. And it forces, as an art, visual artist, forced me to make environments that really stick together through shaders, where I can take any object from my, you know, from Blender or whatever, stick it in there, and it will look at it as if it's a part of the world, instead of it, you know, being hand and then baked and stuff. It just drag it in there and it'll do its thing, and that's super efficient. It allows me to do what I love most, is just create environments and work with colors. So yeah, it's a limitation, but it also, you know, it opens up new doors, and that's super interesting to do.
I'd love for us to look at some of this, like, in the editor now, like some of the
pop it up.
You're talking about. Yeah, let's pop that up. So we'll look at Thomas's screen now. Get a better idea of this unified look. And I think you're going to strip everything down for us to show us the base layer of the art.
So here's the game just running. I can go through the menu. It's I'm landed somewhere. I can take off. But so this is one location. Let me go. I can go to the photo mode and pause for a little bit. So, I use very minimalist 3D models. So if you go through this town, let me actually say, and it's everything about my game is, simple. So, there's one scene, the main scene, there's no extra scenes. So everything gets loaded and remains loaded. The fact I don't use textures means I have plenty of memory left, even on the Switch, and on the more next gen platforms. Most of the audio is not even uncompressed, you know, it's just compressed because it needs to be compressed. It's at the highest point because there's plenty of memory to do it, and it doesn't have that. My scenes are really simple, you know. There is some code repositories, there's some pooling repositories, and then there's, you know, just the world. And if we go to the scene editor, the world is just there, you know. It's just everything's static at the moment. But it's just objects like this, and they're kit bashing. I don't know if you probably heard that term.
Yeah.
I work like, I love kit bashing. I even love to watch videos of people real modelers, like people who make actual physical models, and they have these boxes of stuff, and they stick together with some glue, and then they paint it in base colors. I love doing that, but I'll do it in my own simple way. So I have huge libraries of stuff.
Anyone who's not aware, kit bashing is taking a bunch of objects or assets used for a specific purpose, but then combining them and reusing them for a new purpose, right? And
exactly.
So the asset store, we have kit bash assets on the asset store as well. You can check
that out. Yeah, yeah. And it's lots of fun. It's very creative. Yeah. I enjoy making these towns from my own personal library of models.
I
have a master visuals manager that has all the day night stuff, and it means I can. So this is one of the things I did. I might have spent close to 6 months throughout the years making this day night cycle, and it's just one slider going left to right day night.
That looks so good.
And for those fun, if you ever speak to anybody at Unifood who's in charge of gradient inspector panels, So I'll drag one. So for instance, this is the sky color during the day. So this is nighttime, and then it moves to the day. Let's see if we can do that. So this is that red bit. So that's that orange one here. And then it goes during the day and it goes to the night. But you can only do eight little colors. So someone that I would love to have an inspector panel for gradients that does 16 different color pins. We'll thank you the opportunity to ask.
We'll clip this and send it to our internal team.
Yeah, but so gradients is one of the things I found out in Unity is really underused. You know, people would say, well, why would you use a gradient inspector? Well, I have gradients for the light color, the dark color, the sky color, the ocean color, the waves color, you know, the ground fog color, this is the color at the bottom. They're all connected to the gradient, and the time is just the left right on the gradient. And that is such a simple way to do a day night. Yeah, now, of course, I've hooked up, you know, let's go outside of my...
You ever change the gradients?
I've changed them so many times.
No, like, I mean, in different scenes of the game, like, or is it the same gradient for the entire game?
What I've done, because at some point I was afraid, because I fiddle too much and I forget what I do. And sometimes I'll go back, look to old videos and go, oh, that looked really good. Where did those colors go? So at some point I was afraid to touch it because, you know, I thought, okay, this is it. So I made some code that said, depending on your Z axis in the world, because, you know, so here's my open world. There's nothing fancy. This is just in Unity, literally scattering all the islands of the world up to the 5 kilometer world unit mark where things start to go freaky. And that's how I made it. So you don't need to be, you know, that Unity handles that perfectly. As long as you don't have any textures, you can do crazy stuff with all that memory. And that goes fine. I don't know. So here is my sky dome and the light. So when I move so that's the sun actually moving on an actual dome in the sky rendering. So, and then we go inside that bubble and things will start to...
Do you do any occlusion culling? So like, you know, you're facing this, do you do any culling? So like your character's facing a direction,
don't use any,
everything behind gets hidden or no?
No, not even need that. Just what Unity, just frustrum culling is a default of Unity, I guess. But I don't use the occlusion culling because it's an open world, so there's very little, you know, boxing it can do. So why waste the CPU power on this? Well, one of the other things in that sense that's interesting, if I take my materials, I have a bunch of variations, but there is a few shaders I've reused everywhere. So let's see if I can. So this is this is the what's called base material. So that's about as descriptive as I get it. I can turn off the snow off that. I can probably set the snow height somewhere. Yeah. So I can move the snow up in the world. And it does it for... And I make sure every... So I have one for object that give light and object that don't give light. So the boats will have the same shader. Just the snow is just turned off. So it's basically the same shader. And I can, you know, turn on the lights on the ships on every emissive surface. Make them more powerful depending what I do. So and the same with, you know, the rocks. Depending on where I set it, becomes darker, and if I ultimately go all the way up, it'll get some grass at the top and stuff like that. So here it just turned to grass. Use the same effect and now it's grass. It's a super simple model. I love this. So people use low poly stuff. So this is a tip when people go low poly and they keep the facets. So you actually see all the triangles. I know no likey. I don't like when you do that. But I like smoothing groups. So if you're in your 3D package, you can actually define what gets smooth and what gets sharped. And I love, well, this is not really a good example. Let's find a prettier, something prettier. So I love this. So some bits here. Some bits are sharp, some bits are smooth. So something will make it smooth if I turn off the light. So this is the object as its sort of base. Some bits are smooth. This face is its own face, but these are all welded together in the same smoothing group. if you fiddle with that, if you're into low poly, have a day and fiddle with that, because it can enhance models in ways. Let's see if I have a somewhere else where I can go.
For you, this is more of an aesthetic choice.
This is completely an aesthetic choice. So here, there's a good example. So you can see it in the model on the rocks here. It has these sharp edges and some bits are smooth, and some smart sharp edges I like and some I don't. And it will make for, you know, I love it on these, you know, simple rocks. And there's not, you know, if I turn on the light, there's not much going on there, which looks interesting, you know, with having these vertical. I just think it's pretty. I'm addicted to it. My mouse is gone. So where is my camera? So that's these are the same rocks I just showed in the other location, you know, it's the same stuff, kit bash together, and this is touch an effect there. Don't want to touch that. But these are all kit bashed together. Just like the boats are based on all different objects, I just stick together. And you can shoot off each part if you do that way. So that's some of the fun in the game. Explosions. No, I just drop off all the kit bash parts, shoot off. You can target each part individually. And that becomes, you know, I did it. I had a look at it and thought, that's relatively easy. I'll make that part of the game. So analyzing what you're doing and then finding quick ways to do stuff instead of, you know, I need a massive explosion system that looks AAA. Look at what you got and find a solution that works with what you're creating, that works with your, you know, pipeline, as it were. It's sometimes, yeah, it's more satisfying and it leads to quirky solutions. So there's, see, even this has, you know, so here's a questor, which is one of the, and it's just, you know, it uses the same turrets as everything. You'll see these props over and over through the world in different constellations, and I'll make them look unique. Just kit bashing. Love kit bashing. So that's a little bit about the art and the stuff.
Yeah, Harry Alisavakis asks, are you using forward or deferred rendering?
This is just forward rendering. That is for performance reasons. So there's only one. So because it's an outdoor scene, let's see if turn on the lights again. So the reflections are borked because they only work in camera space. But there's only one light source. When you're outdoor, the sun is the most important light. Yet there's lights here. So there is some, you know, reddishness happening, you know, some glow getting diffused from that is, instead of using all of the HDR render pipelines, fancy tricks, which you definitely should use and I'm be using after this and having fun with, I just bake that in my 3D modeling package. So I have some statics because these lights are always going to be the same. You know,
right?
So those are baked into the vertex colors, and then I have one directional light. If you have one directional light, the advantage of using deferred rendering sort of goes away, you can use forward rendering, which is pretty crisp in itself. And I've tried deferred. It, for me, it's always, you know, check out. I have a bunch of dev kits that it might be a luxury, but I will check it out in various builds and see, you know, what runs fastest. And forward in 2019 still ran a little bit faster on most platforms, because it is in the essence a little bit simpler, I guess, is my.
And so when it comes to the floodlights you mentioned earlier that you had integrated based off of the community suggestion, is that a trick? Are those not actual lights? Is it more like
let's see if we can trigger some. I'm gonna go attack my, so there's friendly units in the game, so I'm flying around. I'm gonna actually shoot that, see if I can, here we go. I'm a pirate now because I've fired all my friendlies. And now I go to photo mode. Let's see if I'm, so there's the floodlights going on in the nighttime. And I turn them on whenever a turret has tracked the target. So apparently it's tracked me. This is just, if I were to kind of, maybe I can, you don't need much spotlight, jaded wire. You can see how much I spent on my ocean. It's actually just a couple, it's just a box. If you can see that, or, you know, can you see it's just a hexagon extruded, and then it fades out, and it's double-sided, and it's additive. And for simple stuff like that, you know, this is not a first-person game, so I don't need the detail you would need in the first. And that works fine. And then you use the depth blend shading technique, where it uses the Z render, the depth renderer, to fade out when it's close, so you don't get these ugly intersecting faces. And you're done. You've got spotlights most of the time.
So you don't need to add more lights in your scene everywhere, right? So when it hits your character, it's not actually changing the lighting on the character.
It's not changing anything. I think that's why it runs well on Switch. It's so I think my opinion is we get presented this giant box of tricks with Unity, with, you know, it's like a candy box. And you want to, you know, gorge and let put everything on there. But then, you know, you get to a platform and we, you know, it's a Switch now, but it's going to be VR in a couple of years where you want 120 FPS and suddenly what's acceptable at 60 FPS on your, you know, next gen console is unacceptable in your VR edition of your game. And since we all have to make a living, you know, we all got to milk what we make, you know, across many platforms, across many, you know, devices. So you can't always accept that whatever your platform's running can handle all of that. So to have a minimalist where you say, well, what do I need for my game, and focus on that, can pay off in the end. So for me, you know, the biggest expenditure in this rendering are those, you know, clouds. It's my cloud rendering system, because it's all transparent spheres, all Z-sorted to hell. And that took forever to get a good cloud, you know, feeling going. That's not the default, you know, ray marched asset you now get for clouds, the proper polymetric. Those are really hardcore. And that won't run on every platforms, and text, it's and I again, it's one of those assets where I go, I'm not smart enough to use that, so I won't. So it's just, you know, you pick your battles where you go for now. Okay, for me it was important to make the colors pop and have this, you know, perfect sense of atmosphere in the clouds and the ocean, as opposed to having a lot of detail everywhere or having very accurate lighting. My game is really easy to be able to say that. So it's a false for me to go listen and do this in your first person game, and it will look poor because you need all those extra lights. So, but in this outdoor setting, flying around, you need to decide. I once saw this making off of, what's the little, the Pixar movie with the fish?
Nemo? Finding Nemo?
Finding Nemo. And all the anime, they had this, they had a look, they did research on water, underwater, and what is underwater water on video. So they said, well, it's particulate matter, it's the sway of the ocean, it's the reflection of the rock. And they had this small list to say, this is what water needs to do for us to render an entire ocean. And they focused on that. And I think that's, you know, that you, visually, that works the same way for your own game. Is find the pillars you need and focus on those, and, you know, make those consistent among, you know, make your visuals mesh together within the pillars you have, and don't worry too much about, you know, all the other stuff you can do.
This is great advice. You found the guiding principles for like your gameplay, but then you also found the guiding principles for your art, and you let these things guide you and move you forward and continue to motivate you, basically.
It's very limiting, and it is, but it's also very exciting to you know, the smaller the prison, the more exciting the breakout. Because you want to break out of your own limitations all the time. I want to have epic set pieces, you know, like, you know, with floodlights illuminating the clouds. Cannot do that. But, you know, what's the minimum I can do that makes me feel like that's going on when it's not really going on.
Love that. And you had also mentioned like wanting your game to look good even without all the layers, like the base, having the base layer look good. So can you
I
believe you're going to strip away the post-processing and all the effects to show us just the base rail?
Yeah, so this we're going to see some weirdness going on with some buffer, but this is the same. Disregard this. This is the light being off, I guess. Yeah, so this is the game without any post-processing or color correction. So I use the HDR post-processing stack 2.0. And it's super powerful. It's always been super powerful for its color correction. It's like movie grade color correction. And color correction, I cannot that is so important. It's not something not to do. Yeah. So, but when I make something, I don't know, let me give it something more interesting than the daytime. So here, that's a good example. So this is the colors at work, you know, if I turn off the light. So even when I'll keep on the lights as the only effects, because it'll give that, you know, the cloud projection has no light to focus on. And you get the artifact. Everything is just through the shaders, I want them to feel the colors to blend together, you know, rather than to so that, and with the end result that lights and stuff and contrast stands out, but the base of it needs to feel it's like it's the same world. So every color gets reflected, you know, there's a reflection that's being rendered for the planar ocean, which is not planar, so there's some mistakes, but the colors of the ocean reflect those in the sky as well. I'm obsessed by it. So when you turn off all the layering of the, you know, this is with, this is without, I want it still to feel that consistency. It's not, admittedly, it's not as pretty, but it feels very solid and one piece. Yeah. And I think that is the hardest with, you know, game engines, especially if you're an old timer like me and remember the early days where we didn't have, you know, light baking, all those things. You put stuff together and it just didn't look like it was part of the same world. It was a cube and a plane, and then you made some grass and you put a tree, and it looked like it stuck through there, because we didn't have those, you know, subtle shadows that, you know, blend edges together. But again, if you forgo some of those things, it forces you to model, and so you can see it here. So here's this big red plane that's typical for not, you know, missing out on all the subtlety of shadows and ambient. Right. It looks like a big red plane, but then again, I've shaded it that it gets darker at the bottom because I know that's going to be near the water, etc., etc. So so for me, it's always, if I make something and I make all the world shaders, I want it to feel together even when I have not turned on all the goodies, and then still look good as a design. And that will help you with optimization, because, you know, this is my PC running it on a 2070, so whatever, some fancy, not fancy nowadays, fancy before Bitcoin mining a GPU, with all the tricks. But, you know, if I were to just go to my... I can turn off quite a lot of things. Well, I can keep the color grading, ditch the chromatic, ditch the ambient occlusion, ditch the depth of field I'm not using, so I hope not. And these are things now, auto stuff, and the one that really mattered to me, the color grading, is still there. It's also the lightest one, and that's also on the Switch, for instance. But this is quite close to the Switch quality of rendering. As you can see, it's not, you know, without the shadows. So, so this is actually the Switch rendering, and it maintains its visual consistency, even though it has, you know, if we go to the, it's not weighted. I've turned off all the pre-batching, the Mesh Combined Studio. But normally there is like 200 batches when you turn the shadows on, and when you turn them on, there's nearly double. Oh, and we go to 1,000 here, soft shadows even more. 1,000, so that's 1,400 as opposed to 800. And that's a huge saving, not having those shadows. And once more, when I turn on static batching, which I can do for...
So many new devs will open this like stats panel and look at like the number of batches in their game, the number of like tries in their project. So like, but how do they figure out whether this number is too much, if they're at a good place? What is the best way for them to analyze that?
And it changes all the time as well. So that is really difficult. I think it says so in the Unity documentation, not every batch is the same. Not every pass is the same. Not all batches are created equal. So some batches are really fast. You got to try, you know, you got to decide, you know, nowadays, yes, Switch is the darling platform for indies. Together with Xbox, I'd say, but those have varying, you know, huge, wildly different hardware specs. I remember I did a lot of mobile games as well. Lots of mobile games, and there it was, you know, and there the problem was you have, you know, I can't show the brand on your screen, but I have a cheap Android phone, like you know. $300 worth of phone. I used to have an iPhone that was, you know, what's a $900 top of the line device until I dropped it. Those are both devices you can buy this year, and millions of people do, but they're radically different. So if you say, well, today's generation of mobile phones can do with Metal, you know, nearly console level graphics, you're absolutely right. Will everybody possess that? Well, then you're highly overestimating the amount of people who actually have a top-end device. My partner has an old iPhone 6, you know, works fine. When you do mobile, that I think the, you know, the non-high-end devices, it's still like 200 have less than 200 batches and have less than the same 200,000 triangles, and you'll be fine on most cheap devices.
Yeah.
Go to an iPhone, you can do this. And I think for Switch, I've always said it's about 400 batches and about 400,000 triangles. And I go over that in the Falconeer to 600,000 triangles and sometimes 600 batches, but that's where you see the frame rate drop. So that's, for me, it's just a rough estimate. You know, if you make a PC game and it says 1,000 batches or 2,000 batches, you know, but sadly every other device on earth won't be able to do that. So my rule, I am pretty minimalist. I would say, you know, if you are over 1,000 batches and over a million triangles in view, you are going to run in trouble. If that's your PC performance, you will run in trouble when you go to other platforms. Even when you go to the big consoles, because those are just different beasts, you know, you need to still optimize and pull tricks. You know, you can go incredibly deep with your effects. Doesn't mean you can go incredibly wide as well. So you know, pace yourself and assume that you have that limit. And then when you go over that, it's not a big deal.
Yeah, it's so interesting that you mentioned that. We just had a stream yesterday with the developers of Crying Suns, and they talked exactly about this. They developed their game for mobile. And they were saying, did you guys know that there's 19,000 Android devices that you have to account for when you're building? Yeah. It's not that easy when people say to build a cross-platform. At some point, you just have to make the difficult decision to be like, okay, it's not going to work on this device anymore. We just have to choose. Yeah,
for sure. I think for most indies who want to make, you know, I think the pathway now is you start out on Steam, either early access or, you know, to load up on wish lists, and then you go to consoles later. That I think it's be very careful if you want to go to consoles that you maintain a optimal PC build at all times. And you know, a million triangles, half a million of 500 batches, that is a good target to hit. You know, it'll keep you safe for 30 FPS, guys. If you want to do 60 FPS, you got to stay, you know, keep it low, because people forget, you know, you know, everything, you know, all these effects. Well, color grading doesn't, but I mean, from, you know, influence all these numbers as well. And then if you start to run the same amount of triangles, because I'm lazy as well. So these, if I show the gizmos. Here we go. So I've done some primitives on my colliders, like this giant statue. It's just a mesh collider. It's not even concave. And that's going to hit pretty hard. But I have to do that because I don't have, you know, I'm too lazy to make perfect mesh colliders for everything. But because my base detail level isn't super high, I can get away with that, you know, and still and have the physics not bog up my rendering.
So since your mesh collider, I noticed it's in a lot of the like open space. Can you not fly through that, like between that head and the body? Like,
oh, you can. Well, this one you can go because it's actually using the actual mesh.
Oh, okay.
And this, yeah. People have mentioned that it is fairly detailed. So yeah. Little boxes that. And so this is a sphere collider or a simplified mesh collider. These bloody things you cannot fly through.
Right.
And it's just, you know, a convex hull as generated by Unity. I've made mistakes. So this is one people I've hit myself in the head for, and it's on my list to destroy. Because this is a mistake you make. See, because it's made a convex hull and it's actually occluding a huge bit of space.
Oh, so you'll bump right into the air there. Bump, yeah.
And additionally, because I have very simple pathfinding, I actually have own collision avoidance and simple nodal pathfinding. I'll get a lot of collision mistakes, which I've not on the player. The player actually has fully physicalized collisions, but the AI, if you start doing to that on, you know, I wanted dozens of enemy units on screen, even on Switch. I use this most simplified model to do that. And then that will actually, with these types of shapes, run into problems. So there's places where I don't allow lots of combat to happen because they're atrocious for the collision avoidance, which is one way of doing it. And which is why, you know, again, an ocean world, I've done my best to make it exciting. There's boats and ships, but of course it makes it easier for me to, you know, have air combat in all these open spaces.
Right. Right. And yeah, and players are not usually going to be flying so close and spending a lot of their time
around. Trust me, I can give a substantial percentage of people who get a kick of flying as close as they can through.
Oh, yeah.
And they report on Discord when ones are, oh, look, I hit a collision box here. Ah. That is a lesson I will learn for the future, is to make tidier collision hills. I promise people.
Speaking of the big ocean, I believe you're going to show us the shader and the effects behind this ocean, like how you actually
let's click the ocean, which is not selectable. Where's my...
There was a great question earlier about I mean, we kind of answered it, but somebody asked if like devlogs were considered as a marketing strategy for this game. And you know, like we said, Thomas is super active on social media and he has done devlogs with us before. So actually, if you want to go check out what we're going to talk about now, the fact that he created a textureless limited shader game, I'm gonna like throw it in chat now.
What are you gonna do?
Oh, I was gonna share that your previous dev talk about creating a textureless.
I didn't hear that. So the ocean. So one of the things. So you said you talked about occlusion culling. So this is the water up close, and it's pretty detailed.
Yeah.
This is a fairly massive expenditure. But it's actually, see this shape? It's actually an occlusion pyramid, how do you call it? The occlusion shape. So this is where the camera's at. And then it's just a model I made that gets progressively fewer triangles the further you get away. So the closer you get to camera, the more tessellated it becomes. Instead of using fixed tessellation, which I also use on appropriate platforms, so that's the tessellation you can use in shaders. And this is the bit that goes behind the cameras, because sometimes you look down and the camera, you can see actually the bit that behind the bird geometrically. So it needed something, and that's the camera floats around here. So I made my own tessellation stuff, and it's about 50,000 triangles. And it doesn't the detail for the water doesn't exist outside of the camera view. So when I fly about with, am I in the camera? So I'm in the, so it's, so can I detach that? So, you know, you can see me following the camera. Well, I need to turn off the wireframe because performance is out of here. But now you can't see it. So, see, that's the, I can move forward, but my frame rate is disastrous at the moment in the editor. This happens, but so you can see it moves with the camera. So I can't. Let's see if I.
So you're not loading all the triangles for the entire ocean.
I'm not loading all the triangles behind me. Yeah. And it, instead of letting a system do it, where is my main camera? Just looking for my camera. It's somewhere in the hierarchy, floating about main. No. Yeah, I don't know why it's so slow. Scene view can be horrendous if you do it like so it doesn't exist behind me, so that's one layer of it. And you can see where the different tessellations, the zones, interact with the world. Can you see it? You get this flickering effect, so that's where it goes into a more detailed so that's the base is just an object. Then there's a shader. I can show you the shader. It's not going to be fun, but so this is where I look all scraps of street cred. It's right below the shader.
All the
forge.
Credibility is gone.
Shader forge. I've been working on this game for a long time, so there's some older tech in here as well.
So how long have you been working on the game?
I think these shaders started in 2015 or something. This water shade. So this is this. It's not Amplify or Shader Graph, but it's actually Shader Forge was super competently made by Freya, and it's a fantastic. I still enjoy the heck out of it.
I've only ever heard good things about Shader Forge. So
So there's that. I'm not going to zoom in. Let's see if I can find where I did my. There's a. So one of the things. If I can find it. I think it's even more. There's more. So the core of any wave shader, ocean shader, is, you know, the waves itself. So that's just a vertex displacement. And that is a fairly simple thing called a Gerstner wave. Which is basically, if you have a sine wave, it goes like this. It's just, you know, it's smooth. The ocean isn't smooth. When we draw ocean, it's got these sharp peaks, you know, like a Christmas tree. That is more like an ocean wave, but it's also not realistic because if you have these sharp peaks, that's basically an absolute sine. So you take the sine and you only use the negative values. So you have your sine waves and you flip the ups, you cut it in half, it becomes a sawtooth, sort of, more or less. So you get these, but these sharp things at the top of your sine wave are horrendous to render because they'll intersect when the water is moving and it'll be incredibly sharp and ugly. So a Gerstner wave is a sine wave that has a little soft, so it's like a very sharp sine and then it softly goes down. That's it. And it has, let me see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 iterations. So mine is 7 waves, bigger and smaller. And you can find code of this on the internet. It's just a fairly common way of doing that. Mm-hmm. So that's a Gerstner wave that just displaces the ocean.
So I'm guessing you did a lot of research into how other ocean systems are made to kind of build your own.
I had to research the Gerstner wave when, again, my math isn't super good, and look how other people did it, and people shared codes and examples, and I sort of transferred it to ShaderForge. The main thing is, when you do that, let me turn off the shader for a bit. Am I running? I'm gonna die in a second. At low frame rate. So you see the boats going up and down.
Yeah.
And cheats are not enabled here today. Let's see if I can. This is actually the live version of the game, so I have to refer to everything when I'm done here. Oh yeah, that's fixed. So the buoyancy of anything on the water is an interaction with the shader, which isn't easily done. Or well, I can't ask the shader what the coordinates are for this boat and where it needs to be when it goes bobs up and down in the waves. So there's actually, so I've made that shader, and then there is an entire bit of code. Well, it's opening Visual Studio. I shouldn't have done that. The same code I've made in C#, to display the ocean exists both as a shader on the go away C#. It exists both as a shader and as a regular code.
Mm.
So if I would use displace the ocean with regular code, would be way too heavy. You know, yeah. It's just the CPU would fry up.
So you're splitting it between the GPU and the CPU.
I'm not splitting it, actually. The entire displacement is done through the shader.
Yeah.
So here's the shader, and I can let's see if I can see some changes.
Sorry, I meant you're like raising the boats with the CPU, like you're moving the everything else.
Yeah, so
else,
the boats. Exactly that. So. Yeah. I am calculating it twice, but I can't calculate 50,000 vertices and displacements in code, but I can make code that for a boat, or let's say there's a something bobbing on the ocean, it will ask for the height of the wave from the CPU. So the boats have their own, but it needs to be exactly the same code. Let's see if I can...
So is it asking like every frame and constantly moving?
I don't even do it every frame because that just to optimize. But so here we can see. So here's what happens when there's a storm. I just up the height. And here you can see the beauty of Gerstner waves. So there are these lovely, you know, sine waves, but they have this little soft peak, even though they're sharp.
Right.
Where I would sit, and I'd made the waves visually in the shader, because you know lots of people have that, and then I had to have a sit. And how would the big boys do that? How would they solve it at Ubisoft? And then when I can't find anything online how they solved it, I just assumed this was the way. This was the smartest way I could. And then afterwards, I've met people that on Twitter say, "No, I've done it exactly the way. This is how you're. This is the way." This is the way. Yeah. This is the way. You have to sample it for your buoyancy objects, or your physics or whatever. So that's part of the. So that makes the entire shape of it, and then it's a fairly easy to color the ocean based on the height of that wave, and then you can see the reflection because it's a screen space esque reflection. So here's the reflection map being projected. Wrongly because I'm the editor, but here is projected in the game view. It's a very low res reflection. And then I do you can actually, if you well, it's really freaky, but it gets blurred a little bit, but if you do a box blur that actually requires lots of iterations in the shader. It can be quite heavy but if you displace, if you use lots of sine displacements, which in some cases can be fast. You can create a blur by sine displacing, like a sine wave. A lot of sines, very small. So it's like a jagged edge. I don't know if I can... I don't know which one I use. But you can use lots of different ways to get blurs. So there's a blurry reflection there. And the reason it's blurred is mostly because it's a planar reflection. I'm not using screen space reflections because... I needed it to be very exact, really, when you're flying over it and something hits the water, you want the reflection to sort of be correct. So it's a planar reflection, and that creates inaccuracies when... So this is a perfect reflection. Maybe I should make it daylight a little... why am I not... This is as clear as I can make it. Actually, it's a bit dark. So the reflections are perfect if the ocean is, you know, completely flat. But once I displace it, you know, they're not going to line up with, you can see it here, with the boats and whatever's reflected. Hence, I blur it a little bit and I fake it just to, you know, move it up a bit. So that's one part of it, is just reflection. And then the sky colors get manually, again, it's gradients to say the ocean is this color at this time of day, just for aesthetics. And then you use the depth blend effect again to create these noises at the edges. So it's basically telling me only on, it only works on the intersections of the plane with the water. So if I were to pause and move the, just so it adapts basically. So that's a depth, you can find these online as well. And beyond a whole lot of tweeting, that's it, you know, that's the water.
Can you see then, through the water at all? Like, can you see like anything that's below the water?
No, there's no. Yeah, well, you can see a little bit. You can see it in the depth blend of. Let's go to somewhere slightly. You can see a little depth blend of. You can see it here. You can see a little bit of the edges. Let's see if I can turn off the reflections for a little bit. I can't turn off the functions, I guess. You can, here you see the reflection faking I do when it is not, but you can see sometimes see the little edge, that's the depth blend effect where it sort of fades, but I can't do it too much because, so the problem I had here was, there's a camera recording the world from the mirror universe, basically. But it cannot record the inverts of anything under the ocean. So if these mountains were to go down, it would render mountains going up into the sky underwater.
Yeah.
So I don't know if that makes sense, but everything's cut off at a certain height just to get that effect to work. So not be static. So this object, see, it's being cut off just so that there's no weird reflections under the water of stuff that's under. So it's a little faking where there's a little bit of transparency, but not much. On Switch, there's none. So I believe if I, and actually the most difficult thing, and I had some help with Jasper Oprel for this. This is a depth, and this is a custom thing he did with command buffers and some magic I can't do. There's actually shadows on the water. You can see it here. When I move the, so you can see the shadow of the rock statue moving across the water, in combination with the depth blend and that little bit of transparency. That was a fairly reasonable sized hack of how Unity does shadows using the command blend. So you can do that in Unity if you you're smart enough, or you find someone who's smart enough for you. In this case. And so that's a really cool feature. Ideally, the thing I'd in some of the first footage, I didn't have the shadows and I didn't have the depth blend, but I could have ambient occlusion on the water. That was also super nice. But those things also don't play fair, and I never got that to work to get the ambient occlusion on the water. That would have been even more amazing. So yeah, that's the water. There was this thing last year where everybody was sharing water. So now it's a rite of passage for, look at my water. So that's my water.
This is my water. There you go. There's your water. And so we're going to go on a break soon. But right before we go on that break, I'd love for you to just quickly show us the... you have a character creator tool you've made.
A what?
Character generator. A character generation tool.
Oh, for the NPCs.
For the NPCs, yes.
Yeah, let me reboot the game.
Randomize.
Yeah.
So it's some procedural generation, but I wanted the game to have lots of NPCs, and I'm not a great drawer, and again I don't use textures, so they had to be 3D portraits. And again, I have to stick to my own rules on, you know, no textures and a certain simplistic style. So here are the portraits, and they're chatting away. And if we go to the, so those are generated. And if I, let's see which one am I here, and I can create, you know, it's just seed based. So random by seed. So these are female. And there's androgynous, or you know, it's not a binary thing. It's a very fluent generator, and it generates all these different portraits. And these are all Mancer, so they have the Mancer outfit. I don't know if I can change that quickly, but you can go on forever and ever. And if you go to the main menu, when you start the game, you can select your own, you know, well, these are, let's go with two more. So they have different outfits, and they'll generate procedural dudes. Or, and it's the, this is the female or the feminine version of that generation.
Hmm.
And if we go to see if we can find that. And they exist in the world. So this is where we were. So basically what it does, it's a bunch of props, but it also displaces and skin tones and hair, facial hair, but also displaces the jawline and the shape of the face in the shader. So it'll make the jaws wider, flatter, eyes higher, more slanted. And it only looks good from the front.
Well, you only need to see it from the front, right?
So. You only need to see it from the front. I have, let's see, where's the one? But this is one, a different. You can see all the props on here. Let's see.
I noticed the talking checkbox. If you check that, will the character just start to.
Yeah, so if it's talking, if we were to go here. So it's not full lips. It's a trick I used. So I don't have the voice, but when you watch any video of the gameplay, you'll see I call it Muppet lip sync. So what I've done, I'm analyzing the, and there's some code on the Unity database to do this, the output of audio source, and it will give you the frequency at certain frequency. It will give you the output at frequency. It's like a Fourier transform or some fancy math thing, but basically you get a number that says in this frequency range, this is how much this wave is outputting, your waveform as you would see it in an audio editor. With that number, with that sample, I've created a very fairly random, I'll try to, don't laugh at me, I'll go animation.
I love it.
With several emotions that blend, and you know, and more static and a more blah blah blah, but basically it's a randomized gibberish talk, and then I blend that to mouth closed based on that audio number. So it'll be blah 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 when based on if sound is coming from the voice emitter. So the lips themselves don't move any way logical for vowels forming, or but they are shut when there is nobody talking, and they open when the voice is playing. So when a voice is heard, it's, and that works miraculously well.
Yeah.
So I call that the Muppet lip sync, which I think for stylized characters is fine. I can't hear it now.
Yeah,
when you try it out, it's, if you do it accurately enough that it really closes with the vowels when you hear it, you won't notice it, you know? That's the trick. Tricks I do. I have fun with coming up with, you know, a simpler way of doing it, because I've worked with, you know, proper enunciation software where you have to teach the, you know, the model the O's, the A's, the U's, and it's like, can't be bothered. So it's just, and that's, you know, how I generate the portraits. And basically I have hundreds of props and, you know, shapes and skin colors. And what I did is, when I needed a character, I'll have a little button I can press in the editor. It's not active in the live version. It's the proper build of this. And it will just auto-generate characters for me. And I'll sit there listening to the voice actor who delivered the voice performance. And I'll just find one that works while it's talking. And I'll just go through all the possible random characters. That's one. And I save the seed, and then the seed becomes that character. So I never manually create any of the characters. I just pick one that sort of works from the, you know, random select. So it's not fully procedural, as in, you know,
it's not random in the game, but it's random for your creation. Yeah.
And I think I use it very sparingly, but it's something I enjoy experimenting with, and just like mission generation, or, you know, for instance, how the wave splashes. So you see little splashes. Well, not at the moment, of course, because camera is too high. But when the camera is intersecting some of the rocks, it will determine. It will just random send out rays. When the ray hit a rock, it will find the at ocean height and then generate a wave splash there. And those have a little audio effect. And there's on an Xbox Series X, there's like 64 different splashes being generated, which it can do. So six every couple of frames, it will look for a new splash. So that everything is split on Switch is like six, but they're still there.
Yeah.
And it's an easy way to optimize. Okay, I have an effect. I can have six instances, or I can have 60 of them.
I love that you've involved the camera in this technique, so that, you know, it's only where you're looking, and it's not happening elsewhere where you're looking. It doesn't matter.
Of course, sometimes that goes wrong, or it can't find. So just randomize where the ray gets cast. And you only make sure you cast only one ray per frame, or, you know, every 10 frames, you cast a ray. And you can get infinite loops. Oh, if there's no ray found, just do nothing. That's tricks you do. I enjoy generating stuff like that, the way the boats go across all the nodes, and they have their own sort of trading logic. Nobody will figure that stuff out, or it's not visible. There's just pretty boats sailing by, and but to me, there's an entire trading network of boats going back and forth and doing their thing, which I will reuse in a future game, hopefully. But
oh yeah, that's really cool. Nice.
Okay, great. So you've shown us so much. I think we're gonna go on a break, and when we're back, we're gonna look at the clouds. And I know you're very proud of like how these clouds are implemented, and they look amazing. So you should be very proud of them. So we're gonna dive into that and like dissect how you achieved that look. But for now, we're gonna go on a 5 to 10 minute break. So stay tuned, and we're gonna be back with way more content after.
Thanks, everyone. See you soon.
Right, thank you. See ya.
And we're back. I hope you guys got a nice little snack during our break. I know I had a little sip of tea, some more tea, and a couple of bites of chocolate. But we're going to be...
I had a whole sandwich.
You had a whole sandwich?
I had a hot plate of Indonesian food.
Yeah. Wow, everyone got such great food. Okay. Chat, let us know what you grab as snack. I always love asking that question for some reason, because I get hungry during the stream. So we're here with Thomasella. Hi, welcome for still being here. We're talking about The Falconeer, which releases on Switch tomorrow, so definitely go check it out. But we were talking a little bit about what it's like to be a solo game dev. We just covered some things like shaders and how he made a great textureless game, the art style, and lots of cool deep dives. But now it's the clouds, because the clouds are very special. So Thomas, tell us a little bit about the unique look at clouds in Falcon. I mean, you're spending almost all your time in it, so.
the clouds for the Falconeer give a sense of space when there is none, when there's no rocks, mountains. They give you a sense of space, movement, even just the look of it. I grew up, my grandpa came from a line of framers, art framers, for what's called the Haagse School, a school of a lot of seascape oil paintings and watercolors. And they always had these, and the Dutch sailing ships and coming in, and all these moody skies. So that was one of the things I am quite proud of, is that the clouds in the Falconeer can be quite moody for a black
word.
I wanted to do and then again, this is one of the situations where I'm not smart enough how to understand how ray marched volumetric cloud rendering works. And if you go online and read on the tricks the people from Ace Combat had to do, there's a fantastic blog on how they you know, pulled that off. And those tech, you know, there's assets for it in the asset store for Unity. I found that way too intimidating, and I knew that, you know, it might require textures as well. So, and then I get really stubborn. I'll try something myself. So I'll have a little video of, I don't know how long ago, but years ago, the very first iteration. I'll take from there and then go in editor and show some bits. So this is really an early version of the Falconeer. And you can see the clouds. So this is, it's actually, some of the lighting in this is nicer than the final clouds. Mm-hmm. But here it says, so they're basically spheres. And I use the Fresnel things to create transparency, put noise on that, combine those to create an alpha transparency. Then add lighting underneath for each sphere. I removed that, and I'll show you why the individual cloud lightning I removed. So we'll go away if we left it. Let's find some dramatic clouds during the daylight. So you can see the clouds here, and they're nice and occluding off the town underneath. They look a little different to what I just showed in that video, but they are basically the same. They are just spheres in the world. If I go to the scene editor. Of my Skydon. Oh, Gizmo. That's why the performance was gone. I'm at the wrong place. I do this a lot. So here. Okay. So if I look at this bunch of clouds, for instance, they're just spheres. So they're just balls. And they get spawned in front of the camera and removed behind of the camera. So they behave a little bit like particles, but I needed some custom sorting that prevented this from being particles. And I also needed them to be testable. So they have a little just a little intersection with the player. And if the player is inside a cloud, they can be stealthy. That is a feature I never truly used in the game. Because it's a bit tricky, but it actually detects when you're in a cloud and then enemies lose a track of you. So that's why I didn't use the particle system, because, you know, getting information out of that is a little, can be tricky. Mm-hmm. They are spheres, and let's use a puff static. So you can see, let's see if I can break the illusion a little bit. You can see its spheriness.
Yeah.
And it does the same thing. So I just use the Fresnel of the circle to hide the soften the outer edges as a transparency. So you get a soft puff. I have a noise. And the thing I did that prevents individual clouds of sphere lightning, as I did in the, is that I added triplanar mapping to each sphere. That means that the noise that is projected, that is mapped on the clouds, is world space dependent. So that's just a Perlin noise I generate at the start, but could be a regular textual or normal map or whatever. And those blend together. So if the objects are intersecting, the noise pattern is going from one sphere to the next. So that creates this effect where a couple of spheres can become a more interesting cloud, and they sort of mesh together. It's just the noise pattern is exactly the same color. If I were to individually light each sphere, you'd see each sphere. You'd see this is a different cloud from all the other spheres. But once you have this noise, they can be the same noise. That prevented me from lighting the thing, because once you light it, it can only light the spheres. So that was my main problem, but they are lit. Let's make it actually a more interesting. So they are lit based on the time of day. So this here's a little interesting blue and red combination. So they do get lit only I'm taking this gradient, which now is going from this red to this sort of teal-like green. I don't know if teal is the right word, but greenish hue. That is the that calculation for the sky, just based off the camera angle and the sky dome, as it were. And I'm taking that same calculation to project those same blue to red gradient across the skies, across the clouds. So if I were to turn off the distortion I use, they would just hide in that fog because they'd be exactly the same color. Maybe I can do that.
That would actually be interesting to see.
So if I just make the noise size. So let's see what I have. Edginess. Just enhancing some of the blurring. Okay, I can't show that really quickly. But the next thing I did was take those colors and distort them based on very simply on the noise I had and use that as a sort of a bump map or whatever, just a distort map. So this color red, which is here on the clouds, gets this pulled to the right, and this color blue is get pulled to the left based on the noise pattern. That's why this cloud is actually the color from over here.
Oh, nice. Interesting.
And because that's camera based, when I rotate the camera, you know, it will shift to, you can see this is that red sunspot and this is the blue, and it gets distorted and added based on that sky dome. Now that only works because that sky dome code is in literally every shader. So that is a labor of love for, you know, the dozens of shaders. And then there's like, in the end, you with variants, you end up with quite a bunch. They all have that same ability to pick this exact color gradient and use it to either light their sides, but in this case, to distort it across the sun. So you can see it really well. So this is this color, but it's got just a little bit of that color. And then I do a little bit of dark light on it, and suddenly you've got this. I've killed it now with the settings and the slider, but let's see if I can take away the edginess, make them soft again. And then, of course, on Switch, they look like this, and on they look a little more detailed on Xbox.
Yeah.
And then, because they're simple, transparent objects, you get sorting issues. And we all hate sorting issues. Mm-hmm. You know, but that's less of an issue because of the triplanar mapping and the way it's mapped. Is that this cloud and the sphere next to it will be practically the same colors. So if they clip, if I can get it to clip, that's the sky projection. So here's the cloud. So I can try to get it to click, but it won't. It's probably clicking. You see?
Yeah.
But they're so similar in you know, that you hardly notice it flying around. So you get, you're basically hiding the limitations of the effect. And that's why my, you know, why it runs on Switch, even though there's a lot less clouds. It's only heavy because of the alpha sorting that's going on. And even with that, you can, in one of the things I did, and I honestly think I need someone at Unity to tell me if this is nonsense or not, but I've changed the transparency sort axis, and I believe that on Switch I've used it orthographically, so it's only sorting down axis. So I think that's what this setting is for. And that saves the perspective calculation, and it's a little faster on Switch. And it's, I don't know any of this. I'll look it up in the Unity base, but in the end, it's just trial and error. Just run it without, run it with, and make a little toggle on your device. Turn it off, turn it on. Oh, I gained 4 FPS. Okay, that's a keeper. So that's, you can see my sky effect.
Yeah, chat is asked if it was a skybox. It's like a sphere. I think when you can zoom out.
It's a sphere, and it's, yeah, well, so this is the sphere. So this is that color calculation. And you can see it's completely world-based. And there's some sort of, and there's some fake ass, you know, the same noise that's on the snow, that's on the clouds, that's on the ocean to do the foam, is the same noise that's on some planes, but stretched out.
And this is linked to the gradient that we saw earlier. Like these colors will change based off of the time of day.
Of these clouds change again on based on. So one thing that's where's my. Where's that? So No, they don't actually change that much. They just seem to be additive or multiplicative. But they change due to their nature, as it were. Actually, the useful thing for that is to use global floats for your shader globals. So you could say, well, I have this color called, you know, the ocean, the light color. Used to be called main color, but that's conflicts with the Unity internal naming. So the light color is a global. So any shader can just get me the global color, light color, and that uses that as an import, and it will give it the correct. So global shader floats are super easy if you make code like this. And again, it once you put all these things together, none of the details are highly detailed. But the combination of tricks creates very atmospheric, you know, stick some clouds in the water. The reflections, if they turn on, become... I've messed up the clouds a little bit by sliding the settings, but... it's that combination of tricks that make things work. And it's not the individual detail. It is the you know, things that are this. There is a super subtle, you know, the difference between the light color that's at the horizon and it a little bit above and beyond, and how that's also the fog in the world, so that moves forward at a different. So the let's see if I can where out of time at. 1.3. Let's see if I can. So that's probably this color. So here I made it really ugly, but that's the ground fog color. That's, you know, subtly different than now it's horrendously different. But just by changing that a little bit, you can train. You know, you need to tune it and not make it toxic like this. Yeah. But you can slowly tune just by one color. The, you know, then the ocean is probably not that, but let's see, the ground fog, well, sky color, it's probably, I can't make any more, let's see, make everything white, and it becomes an entirely different scene, but, you know, it's still coherent, just all uses the same rules.
Yeah, wow, that's really great.
And the cool thing about using gradients is saying, oh, wow. You can set the sun, and it's now a time of day that is... You know, your local, the Chernobyl of the game.
Yeah. Harry Alisavakis, who's another great shader master from the community, just says, literally smoke and non-runtime mirrors.
It's all smoke and, it's all smoke and mirrors. And for me, there is so much wrong to this scene. If you would go to anybody who's doing proper lighting, you would get a heart attack, you know, because shadows, it's just one shadow, you know, lights are not emissive anywhere. But it works, you know, as a visual, it works for me. And, you know, you can see the same thing, you know, the thing I do with making coherence is that ugly green I put in the ground fog is now reflected in the clouds, because that uses that same global color, for, you know, and subtly it's reflected in the horizon and stuff like that. That is such a now you know my trick. That's literally it. You know,
This makes it really. I personally find this really fun to mess around. Like, I'm the type of person that would go in and mess around with colors like that for like ages and ages. So I actually really appreciate that you can really set the mood for any scene. Easily,
and you asked, and I never answered earlier. Do you do any, you know, do the gradients change? If you move along the world, the entire world comes greener or bluer. So there's a place in the game. I hope this resets. called the Maw, which is a horizontal, you know, a giant canyon that runs across the world. And in the world lore, there's South Maw and North Maw. And each has a different color palette if you fly far enough. So it's the same color, but it's just color shifted a little bit.
So when you move further out into different parts of the world, does that sphere follow you? The sphere that's
yeah, for sure.
You're always at the center of that sphere, I'm guessing.
Yeah, the sphere is just set to the camera.
Yeah.
So, blah, blah, blah. Oh, this is wrong. I didn't want to go here. I've messed up my class so poor. It's sort of nice. No. So I've messed with the clouds. It already looks slightly different. So this is the more. So this is another thing. I do things. So this is a water canyon called the Maw in the game. I was flying around my ocean world and getting lost all the time. Because I had no landmarks. And that was before I made the mini map. Because, yeah, even I had to admit it needed a mini map. So I was flying around getting lost. Why am I getting lost? It's because you have no landmarks. You have nothing to orient yourself by because it's the ocean. You know, you have these islands. But if I were to use people say, well, it's a very short render depth. It's very foggy. That is intentional because that makes it atmospheric. If I render too far away, it totally breaks the illusion of my world, strangely enough. But I needed something that I can make a mountain range. And I thought, and some voice to me, remember the Star Wars. I need a trench run. So when I wake up, I said, okay, that's my landmark. It's the biggest trench run I can do. I've got a trench run right through my game. So that got me set on a, you know, this. You're already displacing waves. So this is basically, again, a sign based on the Z coordinate, you know, that moves the waves down to create a canyon. And I can change the shape of the canyon if I want. And that's it. You see some reflection issues. I've long come to accept that. And one day someone will teach me proper screen space reflections to fix that. So lots of stuff here doesn't have a reflection to prevent my limitations of knowing that. And that became an interesting thing. And that led to, for instance, doing... might be a good, nice, last fun bit. Say, well, okay, I can displace the ocean. Maybe I can animate that over time.
Is that part of the ocean that's forming a canyon the same piece of mesh that's going across everything?
We'll go back to an interesting piece in a second, because it's the same mesh, so it's just deformed in the shader and then again in that sampler code. Let me cheat, yada yada. So look ahead here. So I missed the animation a little bit, but here is an entire temple based around the idea of displacing the ocean just on a circle. Making a circle in a shader isn't that hard. Again, it's just, you know, trigonometry, I think is the right word. And here it's turned into an unearthing what's beneath the waves. Because I think, you know, that's cool. You have to say, okay, it's a boring ocean world. I see that in reviews sometimes. Yeah, the ocean world gets a bit boring. But that's because you need to play in 6 hours and then you find these things underneath the ocean, which gives me a kick. You know, there's caves in the world with holes in the ocean. It's the same trick. You displace it and then you clip it and you've got a hole in the ocean. I actually did that because someone on LinkedIn said that stairs down in BioShock in the intro is the most difficult trick in game development.
Oh, interesting. I didn't know that.
No, it's not. You just clip a hole. And so I had to have caves. It can't challenge me like that. I get triggered.
Nice.
So that's and the final cool bit is let's see if can. It's in the. I have to restart. Is I had that maw, and then you have one shape that goes down, and I was, you know, trying to. I got a little cocky, said, I'll make an aqueduct. So I need to make a bridge across that maw, because that, you know, hammers home the fact that it's an unnatural place. Mm. And this is that bridge. Let's see if I can get to where it's at. Come on, give me something at the center of the camera. So here's the maw. Don't mind the reflections, because that doesn't work. Hello, camera. Oh, here's my map. Here is an aqueduct across the water. So you can fly underneath,
mm-hmm.
and you can sail above. The boats go across this, and it's seamless. It's that is that I this is just plain old hubris. It's a simple trick, but I can have such fun doing this. Let's see if I can erase it. Where's the water?
Now we're doing this live.
Yeah, the water is not a selectable layer.
Yeah, very cool.
Level design that.
Yeah, thanks for showing this.
Yeah, Ocean Verge. I make typos. It's just, you know, it's because you're displacing. It is displacing on world coordinates. I can make the same plane with the same shader, and it will displace exactly the same. Plus, it's world position coordinates I used in the shader.
Hmm.
And then, you know, I don't know where it was, but obviously I shouldn't. So then then you put some stuff in to mask it all out, and suddenly you have a cool place which was just born out of Thomas. What, you know, probably getting frustrated with a bit of code. I'm gonna make something fun. Yeah. I made something showy, and then I made an entire town, and this is now a linchpin of the story, because I'm a lazy writer, and if I make something cool, I'll just have a think afterwards and a sleep on it, and then I'll find a way to fit it into the story. And that's that's a nifty little trick.
Yeah, so, very cool. Yeah, we should. Okay. Yeah. So that's really awesome. Thank you so much for showing that. I really wanted to, I thought it was really special. And then I know you were really proud of it. And I think chat realized too, because they're like, you can really feel his passion for it. I agree.
Yeah, I geek out a little bit.
Yeah, but we all do. So it's perfect. Harry Alice Fuck has asked him, are the canyon areas defined in the shader, or is it a texture? There's no textures, right?
No, it's actually, if you look at it from above, it's just another sine wave according. It's very simple. So it's a small. I wanted to make it bigger, but then I forgot. And then you put all the stuff in place and you can't move it again. But it's just based on the sea. So these are the two sine. It's one sine deform. You can see the sine wave basically. It just goes straight. I'm really rather lazy. And then I manually placed rocks in it to make it look epic.
How do you map the sine wave to this part of the ocean? Versus the rest.
Well, it's just world position. So you take the whatever deformation and you add a sine based on an interpolation between the Z val X position of 0 to 100 or something it was. It's not a complex bit of math. Yeah. You know, sine waves, I don't know. They're masters of the universe, I guess.
Amazing.
My water ending.
Yeah, so how do you do boundaries? How do you do like the end of the world in this game?
There's no end of the world. Or? You just like Minecraft after 5,000 units. After 5,000 units, your float precision goes down.
Yeah.
And since I'm not Star Citizen making, I just accepted that. And there is a lore reason why stuff gets weird. So it just continues forever. Nice. So you can fly all the way until Unity starts to go. The only thing I did to prevent this is because the GUI itself, so let's handle that as the final bit. Every bit of this GUI is basically, where are you? 3D objects.
Right.
So there's no Unity GUI. I don't know what people use nowadays in Unity. I use 3D meshes.
Oh.
Actually the shape of this is all geometry as well.
Oh, nice.
And that is mapped to the camera, so that if the camera starts to shake, that it remains fixed. So you actually need to go up to 10,000-12,000 game units from the center to notice that the float precision is getting off. And you see it first in the shadows becoming inaccurate, and after a while the bird starts to shake. Okay. You can definitely go do that.
Okay, yeah.
But I always assume myself. People will go bored before they get to that where that happens.
So you know people are going to be an interesting YouTube video. Yeah, exactly. So we've talked about everything except for the bird itself. Let's see.
Oh, the bird itself.
So the central character.
See the thing that's in front of you all the time. And I teased it right at the beginning. We talked about how you used one of the assets or assets kind of bring this bird to life. So maybe you can just, I'll just leave it to you to tell us all.
Well, the tails are, there's a couple of extra I'll show you. So the base bird doesn't have the tail animator. I needed it for dragons. So the dragons are one of the main enemies in the game. What, drakes or weavers, as they're called in lore, people riding them. So it might be, I said, might have, dragons are boring. They're not that boring. So they had to be in the game. So they're there as enemies and friends. Maybe there's some in the distance here. And at some point, you have different classes you can pick. I thought, okay, people are, they were literally, can I fly a dragon is one of the most requested things in the game, feedback I got. So I made a drake. And so the enemies have the tail animator. And that was super essential because you can see one dragon flying. Sorry, I don't know where my screen is for you. Just in the back. I don't know if the resolution grabs it. So I needed that for lots of enemies that have tails. And if I can find some... you can see how graceful the anime... I made a similar version. And like I said, there's this thing... when I say I'm not the best programmer... there are people that get Quaternions and people that do not get Quaternions, and I'm a person that does not get Quaternions. This is also the reason that you can't make
two kinds of people in this world.
To prevent gimbal lock, there you cannot make loop to loops in the Falconeer, and that's my lack of programming skills.
Let us know in chat. Do you get Quaternions or do you not get Quaternions?
Yeah, I think that's
what kind of person are you?
It's like a secret handshake, you know, like a Mensa membership. You know, you're definitely smarter than me if you get that stuff. So I made a simple version of that, just using, you know, a look at calculation in itself isn't super difficult. You have a string of bones, and then you look at the previous one. You can make snaky things, as you could just saw there. And then I found the tail animator, and it does a lot extra. So it has a little bit of swing to it, and it's much more performance optimized. And I went, phew, let's use that. And then later on, when I made this dragon, I put it on the player drake. And the result is just spectacular because it, you know, enhances every bit of the animation of flying by having a tail. So when I stripped away the dragon initially, I lost this feeling, and it's hard to convey when not playing the game, but having, and I also made I keep calling it a griffin, but it's a phoenix that does the same thing. Yeah, there you are. So the phoenix have the same thing, and it just, I don't know, it adds a grace, and it was super easy to set up. So I'm
so beautiful.
And if you look the video of what they do with it now, tentacle wise, and the tentacles of my Krakens in the game are just hand animated because, again, that was easier for me to do. But procedural animation is something I'd love to get into because this is all lots of blending of bird wings, and it's not that complicated a blend tree actually. You know, it's it goes a little bit different if you dive, and it's one flap animation. And then one graceful fluttering animation, how do you call it? Just the idle. It's not a super complicated. And the thing, anybody ever wants to animate birds, there's a blog on it by an animation professor. Birds, when they accelerate, flap forward. They're not vicious. They're not pushing the air. That is the number one lesson. If you make a bird and you go like this, it's not a bird. That's a manta ray. It's not doing this. It's not doing that. It is actually flapping forward, and the mechanics of bird flight on YouTube, there's a bunch of, get that right and it's fantastic. Get it wrong and it looks really silly. But bird flight is super fun, an interesting topic in itself. And on a nice photo montage. Oh,
perfect.
That's a perfect way to end.
That's
yeah.
That's no, I can do a couple of questions, but end in a bit.
Yeah, that's picture perfect. Yeah, there's so many questions. People asked, let me grab them. Yeah. People asked them at the beginning.
Do you have any more questions? Throw them in chat right now. We're doing some final Q&A. So I found a question here. By Sonson Triple I. I'm definitely not a dev. When Mr. Sala said that he focused on 60 frames per second because of the complications.
Oh, you dropped
of
off
Delta...
there a little bit.
When Mr. Sala said that he focused on 60 frames per second because of the complications of Delta time and other factors, does that mean that other support team members worked on the availability of 120 frames per second capability?
No, well, there's no other team. There's Stefan Weinker, who helped with the porting, who was essential with porting and doing all the SDK stuff and stuff. But there's no other team members. So the 120 FPS, I did go back and do proper Delta time integrations for the bird and the gameplay, not for everything. So if you play 120 FPS on the Xbox Series X, which has it, all the menus are twice as snappy. Okay. Or not twice, or no, they're a little bit snappier. So it's not a perfect integration, but I took care that the core gameplay and the bird and the camera are fairly frame rate independent, but I did that after for the 120 FPS. I locked the physics to 60 FPS, which also helped. So you can change different time steps. It was a bit of a hassle, but like I said, that was the extra stress of being a launch title. It was something that we got working, which was, you know, definitely something a lot of people enjoyed, that 120 FPS sensation on for the first time on next gen. It just makes it feel next generation, because you know, you as a console gamer, you probably never felt that frame rate. So that just took extra effort.
Yeah, nice.
Another question from Anonymous. How did you choose your publisher?
Ooh, that's a good question. I think a lot of people ask that. Do they choose you? Do you choose them?
You know, I think, let's be really honest. Before I started this, I was, you know, an unknown, you know, without, you know, I had experience and stuff. It wasn't that I had a lot of, you know, AAA hits under my belt. So it's not like you go out in the world and there's 20 top publishers saying yes. You get a lot of rejections. I think that's realistic. You'll get a lot more rejections regardless of how good your demo is, because some publishers have a certain, you know, flavor, how do you call it, certain style they want, certain type of game, certain feeling they want to, you know, or certain topics they want to focus on. So every publisher has a different feel, as it were, in their portfolio of games they like, and something needs to fit and sometimes doesn't fit. Some publishers are booked, you know, they have games signed for years in the future. When dealing with budgets, get ready for a lot of rejection. I think that's I wasn't stressed about that. It's just part of life. I'm someone, you know, I went to publisher and I just explained, you know, I'm this guy, I'm by myself, I'm making it, looks pretty good, looks, you know, people are a little bit excited about it. But I want to work alone, and I want to keep working alone, and I had a burnout, I have a family, I want to be home with my kids. I'm not going to go into a process of, you know, being in the end you do it to yourself. And I said to him, I was really open, and I said, I just want someone to help me and assist me and make it a reality and do the things I, you know, am not good at or can't do. And you know, you have your requirements, and then, you know, at some point you'll find a publisher that matches those requirements or that responds well to that. I think one of the things with Wired Productions is that they are very active with an organization called Charity Safe in Our World. That's about mental health for game developers and gamers, you know, acknowledging that games are escape for many people, but if we don't deal with the issues we're escaping from, that can lead to all kinds of issues in your daily life. And for developers, of course, the same with overworking, burnout. So for me, to find a publisher that had a history with that, tugged on my heartstrings. So for me, that was one of the reasons to sign with Wired Productions, is that they have this social conscience, or this, you know, this affiliation with a topic that was a drive for myself as well. So I think that was for me, it's a personal thing, you know. You fit. I don't think I'm a good negotiator. I didn't, you know, people are lawyers, NDAs. I don't believe in NDAs. All these things give me a lot of stress. You know, doing negotiations, dealing with I get very anxious about it. I'd rather have someone, you know, who I have good, you know, I have trust in. Yeah. But for me, trust is a major issue. So trustworthiness and having a personal connection with people that understand that, you know, not everybody can be, you know, gung-ho, whatever, you know, all these expectations around development, but, you know, treat each other as human beings. I think where Wired Production, they did that for me. So that's why I signed with them, which is, I guess, pretty odd way to do it, but.
That's a great, no, I mean, that's a great answer. And if you're happy with the people you're working with, that's gonna bear good results, I think.
For sure.
There's another question here. I like this one. It's fascinating how you managed to do all of this alone with discipline. What lessons did you learn making this game? And then is there anything you would do completely different if you go back in time? That's a lot to think about. I know you've been working on this game for a while.
If I were to do something, I might not make it. I might reject the launch title. And if I had more balls, and say, I would rather have those 6 months and do the things I've done the last 8 months on a different pace. Then again, you know, you can't say that because, you know, then might not have done them because you might not have felt the pressure. Would I have done something different? I think I would have done lots of things differently code-wise. And there's definitely, you know, code. I look at it and I go that this needs to be refactored so badly. It's like I put a tweet on with an inspector panel for the mission manager. Let's see if I can find it.
But I suppose that's what you knew at the time, right?
So it's well, not really... this is pure lazy growth, I call it. campaigns, complete the achievements, no campaigns. So I use scriptable objects to create missions. There's talks about this. Where's the mission? Oh, yeah. So this is on the right is an inspector for a single mission. If you're at a studio, I pray you have a tool developer that would turn this into a nice Unity window, create new mission, and then maybe have some sexy boxes and put it together and lines and stuff. I just have this inspector panel that just goes, and this isn't even the shortest. This has caused a lot of bugs just from misclicks. Just from what did I click? What did I forget to click? So I love inspector panels, and it is a good way to, you know, scriptable objects is a great way to organize your data and have some sort of data-driven structure based on your game. It's not dots by any means, but it's a start, I'd say. I would like to have learned Unity editor scripting to a degree where I could use it. And that would have made the game better. Yeah.
Yeah. So then one last question on that note then, since you're talking about your code. So what do you do when a game mechanic doesn't work out how you want it in the code?
Okay, so one mechanic that didn't, there's a bunch of mechanics that never worked out. And the one mechanic that didn't work was in the first editions, you could only heal your bird by fishing. So you're diving into the water and grabbing a fish and eating it or having your bird consume it because it doesn't have a proper... Actually, the very first iteration required you to land somewhere and then the bird would, you know, with his foot would start pecking the fish it caught, which looked really cool, and publishers loved it because, you know, it looked Zelda-esque survival sim was all the rage back then, immersive sim. But for a game that has fast-paced air combat shooting, it is a horrible break of flow.
Yeah.
So at some point I just chucked it out, and you have auto regeneration, auto heal, and so if you're not in combat for a little bit, it'll just regenerate you. So you can just, you know, escape for a little bit, heal, go back into the fray, and not have that flow break. But I don't like the mechanic, so I just left it in. And there's more mechanics that I just left it in because it's, you know, and people enjoy it. People got stuck on the tutorial for fishing at some point because I made a bug, of course, a small temporary bug. And people got, hey, I can't fish anymore. And everybody seems to enjoy just diving in for a fish and
people
eating
love
it.
Fishing.
So there are mechanics in there which are left or legacy mechanics. I'll either disable them and sometimes I find a new use for them. So I don't easily actually, you know, refactor out entire bits of functions which I'm not using, because often, you know, I found, you know, half a year later, how did I do that? Because I'll need it for something else. So I usually leave it in. So I have lots of relics in my code. You can do that if you're by yourself. Because it doesn't make for the best readable code. So lots of stuff I do, it works great by yourself, not good in a team. But yeah, I just leave it in and don't be afraid to chuck stuff out that doesn't work. You know, this is a skill that's so important as an indie dev. And I fail at it often, you know, and you can see comments from people when they see something where I failed to cut something away because, you know, I'd grown attached to it.
Mm.
Kill your darlings. Indie dev said, but it's super important. You know, if something's not working, even if you don't agree, you know, if enough people see this is not working, start listening why it's not working and, you know, be always ready to cut or change something if it's not working.
Yeah.
For your own self.
Totally. It's a very philosophical thing. Your child, or in this case, your game is not your game. It's the game of the world.
Yeah, it is philosophical because this is also a work of personal expression. And it's a very slow paced game. It takes about 4 hours to get to any of the epic stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It takes about, you know, 2 chapters to get to a boss. In the end, I might have wanted to change that because I worked back to front. So I made the first part of the game first and the ending of the game last. That means that all the end chapters are way better than the beginning chapters. Mm-hmm. That do not do.
Yep.
Because you will be bait. You know, people will, you know, people don't have patience nowadays. Something needs to grab you immediately. The people that like it love the fact that they got surprised after the, you know, second. Well, holy shit. There's, there's a weapon of mass destruction. Holy, what's that? It's all kinds of plot twists. But I took too long to make those because I was working from the start to the end. And at the end, you know what your pacing is going to be, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, the missions at the ending are much better and more varied than at the start because I created all the tools. And at the end of making them, I knew how to do. So I think Rame Ismail or Jan Willem, you always start, you make the ending first because, you know, that's the least exciting bit from a game development. And you make the beginning last because then you're at your peak of what you know your game to do. And then you can make the beginning as engaging as possible.
Yeah, I think somebody...
That is a lesson.
Totally. I think somebody gave some stats on that. It's something like only 2% of your players will actually reach the end.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Now I can totally validate that 80% will go fishing. I don't know why.
Add fishing to your games right in the beginning, guys, always. In the tutorial.
Yeah.
Fishing, petting a dog, maybe pet your falcon in this one. And cooking. Three things that every game needs.
I have no cooking.
Why did we even do the stream? No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah. Thank you. Oh my gosh. Amazing. There's still quite a lot of questions, but let's give Thomas a break because he's also a dad and he's probably hungry.
Yeah, and I'm launching the PlayStation Switch versions tomorrow. So
tomorrow.
Stick my face to all the reviews and hide under a blanket.
You're that fine.
If you have those consoles, check out the game tomorrow. Pick it up, buy it.
I'm
on Twitter at FalconeerDev. I'm usually very available to chat and I throw random odd bits into the universe if it sticks.
Yeah, Thomas is a great Twitter person to follow. thank you so much. I really hope you have a great launch. I know you're going to fiddle around on your Intel Nook for a while, so enjoy that. have fun. Oh, nice little perk there. Congrats on winning that, by the way. But yeah, thank you everyone for coming by and sticking around talking. I hope you learned something. We learned a lot too. Thomas is always surprising me every single time that we talk. Every time I watch anything, there's always extra tidbits. So look forward to more content coming from the Falconeer. And thanks, everyone. Thanks again, Thomas.
Thank you.
Bye.
Ha 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 ha!